What you are about to hear is part of the Podgods Network. If you have a problem with anything you hear, please write it in an email and go fuck yourself. Enjoy the show.
All right, you primitive screwheads, listen up.
But more of the R-rated film that most other people do. There's some salty language in it and shit like that.
We work very well together, okay?
We did gruesome twosome.
Gruesome twosome.
Pardon my French, but you're an asshole.
These guys are 11.
I'm here for the gangbang.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass.
Inconceivable!
And I'm all out of bubblegum.
Oh, no, not the beast! Not the beast!
Ah! I feel like I'm taking crazy pills!
What? Say what again? Say what again? I dare you! I double dare you, motherfucker! Say what one more goddamn time!
They've done studies, you know. 60% of the time, it works. Every time.
That doesn't make sense.
Is that no substitutes?
Hey, everybody. This is Salty Language, episode 167, I believe.
Yes, it is, sir.
I'm Brian, and joining me is, well... almost always, whatever.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Pretty
and, much. You know, we're at the Camp David location.
Yeah. Well, that's a special episode
but
today.
But joining me is Tony, of course.
Well, duh. Either at our soundboard, Tony, which would be awesome if we could do all this.
Yeah. True.
Yeah.
Yeah. What we have for you today is, actually, we had, we've talked about him before on the show, as I'll mention later.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. B, the gentleman rhymer. Who's known for chap hop music, which we've talked about. We've played some of his stuff on the show a couple times.
Right.
I
think two separate occasions that he's come up over the history of our podcast.
Yeah.
Maybe more.
Maybe more, yeah. Anywho, he joined us, and we had a nice talk with him, and also we were joined by Angry Oz, our pal.
So stay tuned later.
Yeah. But, yeah, that's a little bit later.
Yeah.
But we'll get to that. As a callback. But yeah, it was a good talk, though.
It was a very good talk, so. Which you'll hear. But yeah, we, you know, we got to have our obligatory, at least a little bit of time to rant and rave about shit that may have gone wrong for us.
Right, right.
And things that went right, like Mr. B somehow falling for going on our show.
You know, it's funny because I forgot to mention this to Oz. It's like the way it happened was when Oz was on, and it was just me and him, we were talking about Mr. B, and because he followed us.
Oh, right.
Like that night, we both followed him on Twitter, and he followed the show as well as Oz. And Oz was like, you know, you ought to get him on the show. And then just one night, I was like, eh,
fuck it.
So I sent him a DM, and we worked everything out. So
and then yeah, so soon yeah. You'll be older to hear the. One of the small, we don't have very many interviews.
No.
The few interviews Salty Language has done.
Four or something like that.
Yeah.
Hopefully more to come. Yep. So anyway, what have you been doing since last time?
Well, I did some wedding stuff, which if you follow any of my social stuff, you saw random.
Getting married again?
Yes. Random buzz.
Does the wife know?
Of course, duh.
All right.
We're becoming Mormon.
I was going to say, is this a polyamorous thing, or is this just a whole separate second family? Yeah. Or
God, imagine the income you'd have to have to support
know, right?
A whole other family.
Oof.
I guess I could be that family's deadbeat dad.
Yeah.
So that'll work.
That seems kind of pointless, though, doesn't it?
Kind of.
All right.
You know, I don't know.
I don't know. That seems kind of... I think that's my new goal in life. I want to have two families so I can be a deadbeat dad to one of them.
Why not, right?
Mm-hmm.
No, this last week, and I didn't even know it was happening until I saw it over Twitter, was National Podcast Day, September
30th. Yeah. I know, unfortunately, I didn't notice it until later in the day. I put out a couple tweets, but yeah.
I mean, maybe
thanks to anybody who, you know, threw our name involved in.
Give some love or whatever.
Yeah.
But I just, so yeah, remember to, for next year, guys, National Podcast Day. Fill your ears with not shitty radio.
Right.
And just... semi-shitty podcast.
Right. Like going to saltylanguage.com and just downloading all our back episodes.
Yeah,
just listen to all.
Remember that one episode, and this is a while ago, I did the math on how many hours of content we had.
Yeah.
I'd love to know what it is now.
This is 167, and figure probably an hour and a half average on them.
Yeah.
Because our earlier ones were closer to an hour, hour and a half, and our later ones are more 2 hours.
More 2 hour-ish.
So probably an hour and a half is a conservative number.
Right.
That's a lot of freaking podcasts.
I'm not doing the math, sorry.
No. Well, I mean, it'd be 167 and then half of that, which is what, 83.5?
Not doing it.
So, no. What, 240 some
hours? Stop.
Just saying. It's like 10 days worth of stuff. No. That's a lot of stuff, man.
Yeah.
That's a lot of freaking episodes.
It was a lot of freaking episodes.
Yeah. Anyway. Yeah.
No, the only thing I was going to bring up for the whole wedding thing, because weddings are usually meh, you know. And we had a fun time. It was good times. But the best, and it's the third time you're going to hear it. The best thing I've ever seen at this wedding, which I'm totally yoinking in 12 years when we do the old vow renewal.
Right. And now everyone listening will do too.
That's fine.
Way it'll be trite
it's
as so, hell when it, you
dude,
go to do it.
It's so much better than what's normally done.
And when you do it, I'm going to be like, you're a phony.
You phony. No, at every wedding, there's a goddamn unity candle. And the mom comes and lights hers. And then they light the other one. Oh, they light it together. Mm-hmm. Yeah, whatever. This wedding had a unity cocktail where each side of family poured a little bit in a shaker. They shook a shookud, and then the wife and the groom each drank out of it. Mm-hmm. And what an awesome idea.
Yeah.
For people that enjoy booze such as I.
Right.
I mean, I have a coffee laced with Bailey's right
now.
You
certainly
do.
Yeah.
It's, unity cocktail. That's awesome.
Yeah. That is a pretty cool idea.
It's a great idea.
Yeah.
Plus, you can get, like, I mean, we have a bunch of shakers up here. You get a cool, like, ornate shaker for it.
That's true. Yeah. You know? Like one that looks like something from like H.R. Geiger or whatever.
Yes,
you know?
Exactly. It looks like like you're gonna summon demons with
yeah,
it.
Yeah,
looks like the devil's uterus.
Yes.
Yeah. Sweet battle name band.
If we didn't already battle have a name for the episode, devil's uterus would probably be the other. Although, what was the other that I wrote? Oh, Purdy Brooch.
Yeah.
Because well, you'll see.
Yeah.
Or here, whatever.
We did that. I've been watching. You've ever watched Masters of Sex on Showtime?
Yes.
Dude, that show is amazing.
It's a great show. I just started season two the other day.
Yeah, we're about halfway through season one. What a great show.
It really is a good show.
Yeah.
Yeah. I actually watched it from the start because when it first came on, I had Showtime.
Ah.
So I was watching it, and I was like, well, I'm going to watch it.
Well, nudity.
Well, yeah, that too. Listen, any chance to see Lizzie? Anyway.
It's fair.
Anyway, but yeah, really good show.
So watch that,
mm-hmm.
And I've been watching. Spent one day and like binge watch 5 or 6 episodes of Dark Horse Nation. It's about Dark Horse Brewing in Michigan.
Oh yeah, yeah, I mentioned that too. I've seen 2 episodes of it.
You know, it feels too scripted for me,
right?
You know,
remember I told you I was like, hey, it's okay.
It's okay. Yeah. I really love their beer, and it's only like an hour away from here, and I'd love to take the drive and check out that weird compound with the general store and bike shop and all that.
I'm a little afraid of it, but yeah.
But the show feels a little too scripted for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's probably, you know, I mean, it could just be you got people who aren't used to being on camera.
You put
them on camera and they're trying.
Like, oh, I'm gonna.
Yeah, trying a little too hard, maybe. Yeah. I don't know.
But boy. Because
the people seem interesting enough.
They seem very interesting.
You know.
And they really make me want to step up my beard game.
Yeah.
Because they have some epic
Not
beards.
The owner, though, because he,
his, that's, no, he's got the nose mustache
I don't like
Amish
it.
Look, and it kind of looks.
I don't like it.
It looks like someone like tried to poison it at one time or something.
Yeah.
It's a little thin.
It's like, listen, you got to understand your facial hair.
Yeah.
Like, I know that there's a limit to how far I can grow my beard out before
That's it, what you think. Embrace it, Brian.
I've tried.
No. Don't give
up. Well, you saw the picture I posted, didn't you?
Yeah, it was
the
hilarious.
One online where I just combed the opposite way.
Don't give up. Remember what Mr. Well, yeah, we talked
we'll
talk about the mustache.
We'll see.
Don't give up.
I know. It's like we're doing callbacks to something that they
hasn't
haven't heard
happened.
Yet.
I know. It's because we're from the future.
Well, Oz is. Well, so was Mr. B.
God damn, you're right.
And that's why I said this was a worldwide podcast. We had the U.S., we had the
Australia.
Yep. And
England,
the U.K. Yep.
All represented.
Yeah. We were all over the place. Yeah. We done went worldwide.
Worldwide, son.
Worldwide.
What?
Oh, no.
Ugh.
Ugh, indeed.
How about you, though? How was your week?
Oh, not too bad, I guess. I didn't really do anything much this week aside from I got some rage at my doctor's office because I went. And my doctor's office is only a few, like 8 minutes from my house.
Mm-hmm. That's 8 minutes to build up rage.
It is. Yeah. I didn't build up the rage then.
Oh,
I built
okay.
it up at the doctor's office because I get in there and I go up to the thing and I'm like, you know, I'm here for my appointment.
Can we define this as waiting room rage as opposed to deli rage?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
And the I don't know, whatever, the nurse, the check-in person, whatever. She's like, oh, we've been trying to call you. Your doctor's on vacation until the end of the month. And I'm like, then why did you make an appointment for me? And she's like, well, whoever did it must not have looked at the schedule and, you know, whatever. And I'm like, okay. She's like, well, we tried calling you. And I'm like, and I'm getting pissed, you know. Yeah. And I'm like, so I make a new appointment and whatever. So I, you know, I leave. And then I realized that what had happened is that I had numbers that were blocked in my phone. Didn't realize they'd been leaving voicemails.
Oh, no.
So my voicemail box was full. And nobody who calls me like you,
right.
Which you rarely call me.
No, it's text. Are you kidding me?
Like, there's only like three people that actually call me. Almost everybody else texts.
Right.
You know, and even like you, the only time you call me generally is if there's a specific reason.
If I'm like, I don't want to sit here and type for an hour right. and a half.
And same with Sho. He yeah. generally will not call me. You know, he'll call once in a while. Hey, what's going on? Or whatever. Yeah. Again, when you texting just is a yeah. pain in the ass. But
yeah, sometimes when it's like I'm in traffic and I'm like, I just need to talk to Brian. Nah, I'll just call him real quick.
No, nah, I prefer you text.
Yeah. Well, fair enough.
You know, kill a few people.
Well, naturally.
No.
FaceTime.
Yeah. Oh, well, of course.
So you can see all the action.
Right. Like, oh, I butt dialed you with FaceTime.
That's my ass.
God
damn it, ass time.
Not again. But yeah, so I realized that it was because I didn't realize that my phone, you know, because right. of blocking. I thought it when those numbers called, I thought it just blocked it at that point, and it doesn't. It just means you don't get.
It just goes straight to your voicemail.
Yeah, basically. So,
wow, that's crazy.
So anyone who, at least with my iPhone, I have the 4, you know.
Oh, yes.
So.
We, you know, we're from the future. Our phones sure aren't.
Sure not. Well, I'd like to be, or at least from the current, but,
yeah. Same
you know,
here.
I already told you about that.
I know.
So I'm not going to get into that again because that's just boring. But
yeah, fair enough.
Yeah, that's about it. You know, I'm, you know, a little sad because baseball is
wrapping
coming
up.
To an end. Yeah. You know, my team didn't make the playoffs, so I really don't give a
hey,
shit about it.
Lions look all right, though.
Yeah, yeah. I'll go with that. Well, that's the thing. You know, I have that. And then here
hockey's
in a month, we got the Red Wings.
Yeah.
So
you're good.
The Red Wings will be okay. The Cavs start up here in a month again.
See, there you go. Plus, you could just go on YouTube and watch, like, you know,
and I actually
people
have
fall
a reason.
Off the trampolines and
that's
stuff.
True. And I actually have a reason to be excited about the Cavs again because, you know, LeBron coming back.
Oh,
so.
Yeah, right, right. Oh, Jesus.
So, yeah, you know, as far as sports go. But, you know, I've always said baseball is my favorite
sport. Yeah, it's
sport,
your thing.
So,
yeah.
You know, the first, like, play-in game of the playoffs went 12 innings and it was back and forth and oh man I was like this is what I love about baseball
right
then the next game that was a play-in was like 7-0 and it was just a blowout and I'm like this is what sucks about baseball
this is
times.
Why I don't like baseball
but it's no different than like watching football last night where it was just a whooping Green Bay right. stuck their foot square up Minnesota's ass
yeah
from the beginning
that's been
almost.
Like that's been the Thursday night theme
yeah
is people just get their ass kicked
and I you know it's cool that there's games on these other nights, but I absolutely hate it when there's only one game on and it's a blowout.
Yeah.
Because I'm just like, at halftime, I'm like, I'm done.
You know, we should start doing football picks again.
Oh, God.
That was fun.
We can.
Maybe just do like Thursday night, Sunday night, Monday night or something.
Oh, that way it's only one game picks?
Yeah.
That's not a bad
idea.
Here
we are workshopping while recording.
That's what we do.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's not a bad
idea. Maybe not this week because I don't have the games pulled up and it's...
Oh, yeah, true. You know, okay, well,
we already missed Thursday.
We'll start next week or something.
Yeah.
We'll figure it out.
Yeah,
right. Or we won't, whatever.
Or we'll forget all about it.
Which is probably what's going to
yeah,
happen.
Yeah, that's exactly what's going to happen.
Because we are great at this kind of thing.
So this morning, when I had my apron on, I was being Mr. Mom.
Right.
I'm out here folding clothes. No. What the fuck was I doing?
Man, I was going to say, why are you wearing an apron to fold clothes?
I was just trying to put... I was painting a picture.
No, so you weren't
yes, exactly. Actually, you know what? I wasn't full. I don't even know what I was doing. I think I was just sitting.
You were just parading around in your
yeah.
apron. Sashaying, if
yeah,
you will.
Sashaying.
Curtsying. But we'll get to that.
Now I'm thinking about it, I wasn't doing shit. I was just drinking coffee. But I had on IFC,
mm-hmm.
the old school Batman's on.
Nice.
You know?
Which comes out on, like, the full series comes out on DVD, I believe, next month.
Oh, there you go.
I can't afford it, but... God it's damn it, awesome. I want it. Well, even though, all the episodes are available
yeah,
on YouTube.
You can always ask Santa Claus.
Yeah. I kind of want the Batman instead.
Fair enough.
That I mentioned later.
Yeah.
But we'll get to that.
But So I'm sitting there watching, the kids walk in, and Leah's like, what's this? I'm like, oh, it's Batman. So she sat down and was watching it with me. Uh-huh. And then Logan walks in, and he's like, what is this, some sort of like Batman remake or something? What are you watching? I'm like, no, it's Batman from the 60s.
Yeah, late 60s.
Yeah, yeah. And he was just like, oh, they both of them never seen it before.
Love that show.
Although I had one
problem.
It's
so terrible, but I love it. I know. I love it so much.
I had one problem with the episode I was watching.
Okay. Well, you can pretty much say at least that it was every episode of the show.
It was Catwoman, mm-hmm. Bruce Wayne.
Wait, hold on, which Catwoman?
It wasn't Ursula. It was the other one. Is it Ursula Anderson?
No.
Whatever.
There was Julie Newmar, Eartha Kitt.
It was Julie Newmar. That's who it was.
That's the right one.
Smoking.
Anyway.
Yeah. But she...
enough of that.
Bruce Wayne speaks for her and is going to become her parole officer so she can get out of prison, right? And she's like, you know, I've done so much to this city, I'm going to go back to college and get my education. Okay, fair enough.
Sure.
So that's that for this episode kicks off on.
All right.
Well, of course, shenanigans happen.
Of course.
And college freshmen steal Batman's statue.
Which happens.
Which is perfectly molded off of Batman's body.
Well, obviously.
So she can make
Pure
West.
I just had to do a Simpsons reference.
That's fair. Yeah. And so she can make a Batman costume and then more shenanigans, right?
Right.
Well, her college freshmen that stole this were all easily in their late 30s to early 40s.
Listen,
they all talked like this.
They could be college freshmen.
They didn't even look young.
But I could go to a new school and be a college freshman.
I hear you. But I mean,
this was in the 60s.
This is in the 60s.
Most of the time, 30-year-olds weren't going back to college.
No,
then.
Yeah. No.
It's not like now where it's the thing to do.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, they should have all been like plumbing shit and, you know,
right.
Laying
lusting
brick.
After her.
Yeah.
Laying something.
I'm sure they were lusting after her.
Yeah.
And they were a little rare. But I had, you know, when it's like college freshmen, they all come walking out, and the one guy's like has a receding hairline.
Now, I have to ask you, did they have like freshman one?
They had like the fraternity jackets and the beanies with the matching colors.
Did they have numbers or anything on them?
I don't think they had numbers.
Those are my favorites, like when the Joker's henchmen, it's like henchman one.
Yes. It was just...
I want so badly for them, especially in the pop lines...
To have henchmen like that?
Oh, my God. You don't understand. Oz and I would probably each just...
Just get some of those blank ones and make them.
I thought about it, actually, because I have one blank one already.
There you go.
I've been hoping for them, because I was like, you know, how great would that be? You put up, like, the Joker and two henchmen box set at, like, San Diego Con or something,
right.
You know?
Yeah.
I've been waiting for cool stuff like that, and they haven't really done much of that. Most of the time, like, what they do is... they do, like, metallic variants. Like, there's metallic variants for the 66 Batman pops.
Right.
And I don't really care about those. I'm not looking for chase figures
for
them.
Does the 66 Batman pop vinyl come with a bomb?
No, I wish.
God damn it.
Oh, that'd be so great.
That's the best one.
Oh. No, the Catwoman has, like, a kind of a sparkly costume like she did on the show.
Oh,
though.
Nice.
And, of course, it's Julie Newmar. I've been waiting for them to put out, like, an Eartha Kitt, and I cannot remember the other woman that played Catwoman, because there were three different ones.
Let's see, there's Julie Newmar, Eartha Kitt, and that forgettable one.
Yes. It's kind of true, though, because Julie Newmar is like, how you doing?
Yeah.
With Eartha Kitt, everyone remembers the rah, whatever,
yeah,
you know?
Exactly.
So,
the ruffles have ridges.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. That's a pull.
Oof.
Yeah. But, yeah, I could talk about that show. So, I mean, you know, I've got
the
big Batman. I've got the fucking all the figures.
That's why I had to tell you about this, because it just cracked me up that the kids were both like, what the fuck is this?
I watched the movie, was it about a week ago?
Nice.
Because my mom bought me the movie forever ago on DVD, like when it first came out on DVD, and love it so much.
Mm-hmm.
That movie's terrible.
It is terrible.
It's god-awful, but I love it.
Well, I mean, the show was good enough that I'm like, all right, Leah, you need to go like work on your room because you got, you know, your friends coming over.
Yeah.
She's like, oh, let me just finish this episode. I'm like, all right, I'm going to tell her now.
Well, like I said, I believe Oz had a link for like all the episodes on YouTube.
Oh, well, that doesn't surprise me.
So if you ever want them.
I thought they might have been on Netflix.
They're not.
But I think it's just a Batman movie. And not
I think so.
Yeah.
Oh, I wish they'd be on Netflix.
Yeah, because I was like, it's disgusting.
I'd never stop watching them if they were, though. I'd be using all the bandwidth on that.
And all it is, like, because I had to look. The only Batman stuff on Netflix, streaming at least, is Brave and the Bold, which is fun, Batman Beyond, which is also pretty good.
Yeah, it's a good cartoon, too.
But that's it. There's no, like, animated series,
no,
which
they
is too bad.
I own all of them, that's why I bought it.
No vintage classic Batman.
Right. I've been waiting for them. I'm really surprised they never released the animated series on Blu-ray. I know it wasn't shot in Blu-ray and blah, but blah.
Still
surprised for the money grab they didn't do it. Did box set of it. Well, like, they did a box set of all of them.
Is not HD as it is.
Yeah.
Can you imagine how much you can cram onto a Blu-ray disc?
Yeah.
You know?
Right. Well, that's the thing is there's got to be extras and stuff they never put out there. You know?
For sure.
Well, they did put out a box set at one point that had a bunch of, like, an art book and different that. I just never got it because it's like $140, you know?
Does it look like a giant penny? Because that would be awesome.
No, that would be pretty cool. No, it's just a box. They didn't do anything cool with it at all.
Jeez.
Like, they didn't even make it look like the Batmobile, which is, you know, long and lean, which would have been perfect. Yeah, no. Yeah. And one of my favorite Batmobiles, aside from the 66 one, because, I don't know, vintage. I just have a special.
It's like.
That's why when they said they were making one that fit the 6 or 5 inch figures, I was like, I have to get one of those.
It's like I'm suddenly have an affinity now for like old cars.
Yeah.
I don't know what it is. I think it's because I was telling T this, is because it's not all computer shit.
Yeah.
I want to have keys for my cars.
I know. My mom just got a new car. And it's got this fucking, it looks almost like you're plugging in a USB thing into the drive.
That's what our minivan has. It's like the fob or whatever for it.
Okay.
It's like, the more I've been like, it's like, I just want to get an old car that is so not computerized.
Right.
You know?
Like an old Charger or something.
Something. Yeah. Anything. Yeah.
So I know one of the things we were going to talk about was Gotham.
Yes.
We're going to go from...
I don't know. Well, we're already at the 20-minute mark.
Yeah, we'll be fine.
All right, let's Gotham it.
We can cover it.
I mean, we
can go over a little bit. It's all right.
I didn't really put down a whole bunch
for it. Well, first of all, we're only going to talk about the pilot because you haven't watched the Selina Kyle episode yet.
I have not. Although...
Which I have.
I'm going to say right now, I do not like how they put Selina Kyle... Oh, yeah, spoilers. You haven't watched pilot, I guess.
Right.
Into the opening murder scene of the Waynes.
Which I couldn't agree. Well, first of all, let me say that if you go to saltylanguage.com right now, click on the blog link, my most current blog is about this.
Oh, I have not read it yet, so I'm going to have to get on that.
Well, there may be some spoilers. I don't remember if I put any spoilers for episode 2.
If there is,
two.
Whatever.
I'm just saying.
You know, I'm not that in love with the show yet that I give a shit about spoilers.
Fair enough.
You know?
Right. Plus, a lot of it that's given away, you're going to see coming.
I mean, I have... two things. Yeah.
Real quick. I agree with you 100% on the Selina Kyle.
Yeah. She should not be there. I'm also, I don't like the timeline they're in because why is Montoya there? You know? Because Montoya and Bullock were like partners, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, they were on the animated series. I don't remember if they were in the.
I never read the GCPD.
Oh, you should.
I know I should.
By Brubaker and Rucka. It's fucking great.
You know, I went through a long dry spell of comics.
First of all. Well, it came out when we had a comic shop. Anyway,
I still wasn't.
I know. I'm just saying. Then. I know. I kind of feel like they should have let those guys kind of have something to do with it, like helmet a little bit. Because
something,
dude. If you want crime,
if
you want a crime series, man. I mean, in comics right now, nobody's better than Brubaker at writing crime books. I mean, he is the bee's knees at it.
the bee's knees.
Anywho.
See, I'm not. I don't like that.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah, there's a couple things of some of the characters I really hate right now, but I'm hoping will smooth out.
Donna Logue as Bullock, big fan.
Love him.
Yeah,
yeah.
And as I'm sitting here,
he is, I think, as of right now, my second favorite character on the show.
Who's your first?
I actually really dig the dude who's playing the Penguin.
He's good Penguin. Yeah.
I really. Like, I don't like some of the other... Like, I like his role.
Right.
Like, you know, I don't like how they got, like, a million, like, you know, they keep referencing that he looks like a penguin.
Yeah, why are you walking like a penguin? Oh, I never heard that before.
Yeah. Yeah. I do appreciate that. Did anyone ever tell you you look like a penguin? You know, but anyway.
One thing that kind of confused the shit out of me.
Yeah.
And well, actually, let me take a step back. Because there's another thing I don't like.
Okay.
Barbara Gordon as his wife?
Well, first,
is his wife's name Barbara? Because I
don't believe it was.
I didn't think it was either.
I'm going to say I should know this, and I don't remember. But this is not the same Barbara Gordon.
But it still bugs
me. Yeah, I know. This isn't Batman or Batgirl / Oracle Barbara Gordon.
But I mean, they shouldn't even named her Barbara. You know?
Listen, I totally agree with you.
Because when he's like, ah, Barbara, and I'm like, Barbara?
I'm not.
That's incestual.
I'm not sure. Are they married? at this point?
Well, I think they're just boyfriend girlfriend.
Okay, I was going to say, because I think they give a different last name for her. Yeah. I forgot what it is, but yeah.
But well, someone calls her Barbara Gordon, though.
Do they?
I'm pretty sure.
Mm. Eh, anyway.
And then another thing, and I don't know, unless it's revealed in the second episode, because
mm-hmm.
I don't know what she does for a living, because mm-hmm. there's clearly like, oh, I know what you're up to in the pilot or whatever.
Yeah.
But Detective Gordon and his wife or girlfriend have an amazing apartment for a detective.
True enough, right? And Gotham basically. Well, here's part of my issue, and you know what? And I'll straight out. And God, I can't remember what show it was on now, and I feel bad. I don't remember if it was Green Up or if it was on Graphic Novice when they talk about the show a little bit, and they talk about how they can't figure out what era this is supposed to be.
Right.
Because the cars all look like they're from the 80s, but they have cell phones.
Yeah. Well, they're shitty cell phones. Well, I've only seen flip phones. I don't know if anyone's had smartphones.
I haven't seen a smartphone. But still, it feels...
It's weird.
It kind of feels like they don't know exactly where they're...
Yeah.
So, I was kind of hoping, honestly, that they were going to shoot for more like Batman the Animated Series and go like 60s-ish cars and, you know, but whatever.
Back 50 old cars.
Yeah. Anywho. So... That has something to do with this to me because it's like if this were Gotham is supposed to be it's basically New York.
Yeah, well, Chicago, right?
Or Chicago,
because like Metropolis is like New York.
You're right. Yeah. You're right. Okay, so it's Chicago.
Yeah.
I mean, when
it kept panning to it, I'm like, that's an amazing place to live,
right?
Big, huge, roaring fireplace, yeah. Huge windows that overlook the city.
Right.
I'm like, really? He's a detective. He should be eating like over the sink right now.
Yeah, right. You know, not only is he a detective, he's a beginning detective.
Yeah, exactly. Like he's new.
Cause yeah, it's not trying... like it's Bullock,
right?
You know,
who's
been there a little
and
while,
and probably elbow deep in who knows what. Clearly.
Well, we'll see. Yeah. Yeah.
But I, yeah.
But that's how Bullock was, though. I mean, you know, Bullock was kind of dirty.
Kind of shady.
Yeah.
Yeah. But that was, I had a problem with that.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, that's just, I know it's a show, but right. Like, it's not realistic.
Yeah. I agree with you. I think that's one of those things that you really have to chalk that off to the, okay, I'll suspend.
Like he should be eating Chinese takeout, sitting on his bed, watching television.
Pretty much. Yeah.
You know?
Bed/kitchen table.
Yeah, like there's a curl bar next to him or something, you know? Because he can't go to the gym because he can't afford it.
Right.
Yeah, I was not a fan of the like rich person apartment.
Yeah.
Like, even when he was, even he's a commissioner, he's not going to live there.
Right. Now, it may have something to do with her.
Yeah, and it.
So,
yeah, and
yeah.
That's why I was like, that's the only like leeway I give it is I don't know what she does.
Right. While we're talking about this, I'm going to pull up the IMDb for it because I can't remember the last name that they give her if it's not Gordon.
I thought it was Gordon, but I could be wrong. I just was offended by her name was Barbara.
A lot of people were like, what?
Yeah, because it's like...
But that's not the only naming thing that offended a lot of people. So, because, what's her name? Ivy Pepper.
Right.
Is clearly Poison Ivy eventually. Yeah. And her name is Pamela Isley.
Yeah.
And I don't know why they felt the need to change her name.
Why? Yeah.
I totally don't understand that one. You know, I mean, I can get over it. It's fine or whatever. But I was just like, why couldn't the guy's name be Isley?
It's that easy.
Why is his name got to be Pepper?
Yeah.
That's weird.
You know, because Peppa plants and spearmint and stuff. It's like a plant. You guys get it?
What's all the rhubarb? God.
Ugh.
All right. What else you got?
Just the last thing I had is, boy, did Jeannie hate this show. She was like, why are we watching this? We should be watching Masters of Sex right now.
Or anything else, yeah. She actually sent me a text, which was great.
She was like, I'm texting Brian.
Yeah, and the text said, I believe, if you like the show, I'm not sure we can still be friends or something like that. And, you know, the first thing I will say is it's a pilot.
It is, yeah.
So,
I told her
they do
too.
Shoehorn a lot of crap into pilots, so... In the second episode is, I really don't think it got any better. I really, and I put this in the blog, I really feel like this show is trying to be Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Oh, really?
I really feel like dialogue-wise, pacing-wise, they're trying to shoehorn too many jokes that are not good.
Right.
And listen, if you want to be campy and do that, fine, but 66 Batman already nailed that.
I mean, what I was expecting with Gotham was I was expecting like a gritty crime show. With a Batman shit sprinkled in the background.
And this is why I wish they would have went with Gotham Central
instead
of going the way they did.
Yeah.
Because Gotham Central is exactly that.
That's what I want.
It's a gritty crime book because, again, Brubaker and Rucka, that's what they do. And then the background to it is it's kind of like Batman exists.
That's what I would look
at. But it's not focusing on Batman.
That's what it should be. Because, yeah. I mean, I like in the pilot, I'm like, okay, I get it. They start off with the murder to Wayne's because...
They have her listed as Barbara Keene.
Okay, well, fair enough.
Yeah.
But they start off the murder to Wayne's, which makes sense because you pull in the people who don't really know. Like, okay, yeah. Like here's a good starting point.
You know, I will say this. I'm getting to the point that I feel the same about Batman that I do about Spider-Man is that I'm not...
Everyone should know their origin
and
story.
And honestly, Superman at this point.
I'm not even talking about for Batman's origin story. Uh-huh. I just mean for like people be like, okay, I'm in Gotham.
Oh, I get
you. Like, I know where I'm at.
I get you, okay.
You know?
Yeah, all right.
And then they just leave the Batman shit out of it.
Yeah.
You know, and then have sprinklings of it.
Right.
Just slightly seasoned.
Right.
This is like an everything bagel of Batman right now.
Yeah, that's
true. I just want, like, sesame.
You know, and that was kind of one of the things that bugged me about it a little bit was that there's just so many characters, like, right away. It's like, I don't know that we needed...
All that stuff.
Do we need Edward Nygma
right now? When he's like, oh, thanks, Nygma. I'm like, really?
Yeah, he's a forensics expert. like, with it,
really?
Did you have to shoehorn him?
Yeah.
Real quick, what did you think?
Oh, let's go to this toy store, guys. And let's go see the puppet show. You know, what else are you going to shove in there, you know?
Oh, man.
Need to buy a watch? I know a guy.
Oh, jeez. Yeah. I'm really hoping that the guy that was the comedian guy is not going to end up being the Joker.
I thought, yeah, because I'm like, he's kind of got the angular face, though. So I bet you he's going to be. Although you think he would have like got more kick out of watching Penguin get his ass kicked.
That's true.
Than like, oh, God.
So what do you think of Jada Pinkett Smith as Fish Mooney?
Well, at first, yeah, I don't know.
Because first of all, Fish Mooney's an invented character for the show.
Yeah, I don't know.
For those who didn't know.
I
think she's trying too hard.
Yeah,
I didn't. I could see that for her. But the guy who plays what's his name? Oh, you know what? No, that's in the first episode. Like when they're hanging upside down in the meat. Like, God, what's the guy's name? Falcone. I think that guy is pretty good as Falcone.
Yeah,
and I think overall, I think casting wise, they did okay.
Right.
I don't have a problem with it, but I just, man, it just feels so much like Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. to me, as far as. Like I said, Whedon is the type that he tries to put a bunch of quips into things. Like, and that's why I didn't like Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. It was like everybody talked really fast and they had all these jokes and it was and I was like, this is not
like, whoa,
good.
Easy. Yeah.
Yeah. And I kind of feel like Gotham at times kind of did that too.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of really bad jokes in it.
Well, yeah.
Really bad jokes.
They just, you know, I don't know. It should have been just a nice like crime noir kind of feel. And it's, no, it kind of feels like a swing and a miss.
Yeah.
But I've only watched the pilot.
Right. Though, so. It did 8 million viewers the first week. I didn't see what the numbers were for week two. I'm curious if there's if it's held or declined. Because, I mean, it is running right up against Monday Night Football.
Right.
And, Dancing with the Stars is over.
Other
now.
Monday Night.
Well,
things.
the first show of it was right up against Dancing with the Stars finale.
You know what else it's up against?
Raw.
Yeah, the weekly release of Salty Language.
Yeah.
Duh.
Ugh. Oh.
Yes.
Sorry, I'm looking up Barbara Keene to see if there's actually a character or
if it's made up for the show.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I just.
Well, I was also kind of seeing if it tells
what the relationship is or whatever.
Four reasons why Barbara Keene is Gotham's Kate Kane, who was later on Batwoman. So interesting.
I don't know. I just am not. I don't know.
Yeah.
Just name her something else.
I know.
Why Barbara? Barbara's supposed to be unless it's going to be like she's going to go away and he's going to be like, oh, I loved her so much. When I have a daughter, I'll name her Barbara. Something like that. Which is entirely possible.
Yeah, it wouldn't surprise me. Not at all. I'm trying to think if there's... I can't remember. I know I wrote some other stuff on the blog, so, you know, go check that out.
SaltyLanguage.com.
I wrote a few other things
blogs,
on there.
Bitch.
But basically expressing very similar things that I watched it and I was like... And I watched it again because I was like, you know,
you didn't have enough pain.
Right. And I watched it again and I was like, yeah, I don't feel any different.
Yeah.
Other than I wish I wouldn't have wasted 2 hours of my life.
Mm, that's fair.
And then I watched the second episode, and we'll talk about that some other time. But overall,
I'll
watch
it this week, so we can talk about it
next week. Our pal Eric Palicki, E. Palicki, and the Twitter machine, he made a comment that he felt like the second episode was kind of like a step back.
Right.
Not a step forward. And I kind of agree with him. So
speaking of E. Palicki, he's got his Kickstarter back up.
Yes. So if you guys follow him on Twitter at E. Palicki, or I retweet it, you know, once or so a day.
It comes through the Salty Language thread.
Yeah.
I usually retweet him too.
Right. Or his the name of his book is Red Angel Dragnet.
I'll put the link back up on our webpage.
Yeah.
Too.
So, you know, go help our pal out to get his
last I saw, book he printed. Was in like the high 60% already of getting it funded.
Right.
So hopefully.
And also, I will say, the last time, as of the last time I looked anyway, another book of his, Orphans, which was, what, the first three volumes, I think, collected on Comixology, was only $4.99.
Get on it.
So go check that out, because that was a pretty good read.
You know what? I'll put a link to that, too.
So, yeah, go help our pal out, and hopefully we'll we're trying to get him for the show here before long. We'll get it worked out and have some fun with that.
Because he's going to be in New York Comic Con, so...
Right, actually, if you're going to New York Comic Con, I don't know if he's going to have a table or not. But again, follow him on Twitter, and you'll be able to find all this out, because he'll tell you.
Yes.
So, yeah, there you go. Don't forget this, was it this up? This week, actually, as you're listening to this, I believe The Flash debuts this week.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I see.
Did you watch the pilot?
No, I did not.
Okay.
And
you should definitely watch
a lot of that stuff isn't on demand like I would have thought
yeah.
it would be.
Yeah.
Which sucks.
Yep. Yeah, and I don't know if you get...
It depends on what channel it
it's
is.
It's on CW. I don't know what channel exactly that is. Anywho, but... yeah.
Like, I'm trying to catch up on Arrow. I'm waiting for season two to go into Netflix, because we're DVRing season three.
Okay, yeah.
Actually, if we get Arrow, we should get Flash, so...
Right.
Yeah.
True. Season two will be in Netflix sometime in the next couple weeks.
Yeah, because I'm like...
It was supposed to be earlier, like the very beginning of the
month. I know, that's
why
I was like,
yeah,
I
they
keep
pushed
checking,
it back
like,
for
where
some
the
reason.
Fuck is it? I want to get my Arrow. I got to see some dude do like pull-ups or whatever.
Right?
It's like all he does
every
in the
episode,
show.
Yep.
Like, oh, pull-ups.
Yeah. So, but yeah, definitely check out The Flash. And then in a couple weeks, Constantine debuts, which I know you've watched.
Yes.
And that was fantastic. I'm definitely on board for that at the moment.
Yeah.
That was a pilot that watching it, I was like, yes.
I'm in.
Especially, you know, as it went on, I was like, yep, because that guy nails Constantine.
Yeah, that'll be good, too.
Yeah. As long as NBC doesn't bugger it up at any point by keeping it too restricted.
Not that we're trying to jump on some of our fellow podcasters' balls six by talking about all this TV stuff, but... It's comic book related shows. We're going to watch them.
Yeah. Whatever. Our show is about everything.
That's true.
And nothing all at once.
Wait. I think there was a show like that once.
No, there wasn't. This is the first one ever.
Awesome. We're groundbreaking. Mm-hmm. Speaking of groundbreaking, we should probably get the fuck out of here.
Amen, sister.
Do a groundbreaking interview.
Right.
You know?
So, yeah. So, I think we'll probably maybe throw a commercial in here or something.
Yeah, if someone's lucky.
Yeah. If not, then we'll go right to...
It's like, you know, it's like the claw from Toy Story. We just...
Ooh.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Our promo's being played.
If not, then we're going to go right to the interview with us, our pal Oz, and Mr. B, the Gentleman Rhymer.
Hi, this is Ryan from Green Up. I'm bringing you breaking news straight from our Green Up studios in Oregon, which is code for me sitting my fat ass in front of my computer in my spare bedroom. With the power of editing and quote-unquote purchasing clips off the internet, I bring you none other than Ron Burgundy to help me bring you the news that you need to hear. It's very important. Mr. Ron Burgundy, please tell these listeners what they need to hear.
Good evening. I'm Ron Burgundy, and this is what's happening in your world tonight.
Ron, quit being a little baby. This promo isn't about you. Be a man and just tell everyone what they need to hear.
I'm not a baby. I'm a man. I am an anchor man.
Ron, you're a fictional character from a movie. You don't really exist. You're not a real man.
I'm a man who discovered the wheel and built the Eiffel Tower out of metal and brawn. That's what kind of man I am.
Well, Ron, calm down, bro. Chill out. Love the character, love the movies. You do you, bro. I'm going to do me. But we just need to get this promo about Green Up done and finished. When we're done, you, me, we'll go with some hookers and blow. Is that cool?
You're so wise, but like a miniature Buddha covered in hair. You know how to cut to the core of me.
Wow, thanks, Ron. I appreciate it. I think I'm fat and going bald, but thanks, bud. GreenUpPodcast.com. There's our site on the Twitters, at GreenUpPodcast. If you're looking for a podcast about video games,
TV, movies, and you want some good laughs, then Green Up Podcast is where you need to be. The greatest podcast out there. Even Ron Burgundy agrees. Right, Ron?
It's science.
All right, well, joining us now via the internet is Mr. B, the Gentleman Rhymer. Welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you very much indeed, chaps. Thank you.
And also joining us is the lovely and talented Oz.
I was about to say the lovely and talented Oz. That is probably the most decent and massively incorrect statement offered praising my name outside of my immediate podcast. But it's an absolute delight to be in the company of such giants. Gentlemen, if it seems I am standing tall, it's purely because I am hefted on the shoulders of giants such as the three of you chaps.
Well, I must say, that makes my little hello sound rather meagre, I'm afraid. That's rather marvellous. Well done.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, thank you.
We all feel like shit now, Oz. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. Don't upstage the guest. Now, we've talked about and played Mr. B's music on the show before, and for those of you not familiar, shame on you.
It's true.
You should definitely go buy all of his stuff, and we'll have links for the website and such in the show notes and other things. But your website is gentlemanrhymer.com, correct?
That's absolutely right, yes.
Okay.
Indeed.
So, yeah, go check that out, and you know, you can listen to some of his music and see all of his dates coming up and such.
Even by mustache wax. I was very impressed.
Yes.
You can indeed. Yes, yes. Well, I've just released a new mustache wax, actually, which is to do with all tied in with the forthcoming Acid Ragtime Mr. B the Gentleman Selector album, you see, which is something of what you might call a side project. But it's called Victor's Vapor, and it's... Well, I mean, in the old raving days, I know a lot of sort of chaps that I know these days are kind of, you know, slightly broken ravers from back in the day and that sort of thing. I don't know if this was the same thing where you chaps are from, but people used to rub Vicks Vapor Rub into their chest in order to enhance certain things that were happening within their mind. And so I've managed to find a moustache wax which has the same eucalyptus and menthol flavour to it. So you can actually, rather than spraying some... It's a cold remedy, basically.
Oh, lovely.
It had this sort of real menthol hit to it. So we can now have moustache wax, which has a menthol and eucalyptus flavour, which keep you raving till at least tea time, I'd say.
To be completely honest, during the 1990s, when I was more than prone to go out raving four nights a week, I indeed used to shave using the said Vicks Vapor Rub. So, yes, I wholeheartedly endorse that product. Although I am moustacheless, so...
Well, there you go. Maybe just pop it on the top lip and see what happens, I don't know.
Or just grow a moustache.
There we go.
Indeed.
Yeah.
Indeed.
Come on, Oz, give it the times.
I know.
So I do have to ask, because the lads have actually alluded to it, perhaps the first question that we can actually ask, Mr. B, is... In your estimation, or your definition rather, sir, what is chap hop?
What is chap hop? Chap hop is, well, it's hip hop as reconnected to manners and the Queen's English and that sort of thing. It's, if you can imagine, Noel Coward and Chuck D and Afrika Bambaataa getting drunk together on sweet sherry, perhaps they'd form a band and chap hop would be the music they made.
That sounds like a fantastic evening.
Yes.
So it's sort of Naughty by Nature meets PG Wodehouse.
Pretty much, yes. That's okay. Fairly accurate, I'd say, as well, yes.
So with that aside, I've got to ask you, I mean, you have mentioned Noel Coward and Chuck D, and who are your influences outside? Oh, we could do both. I mean, your musical influences away from sort of the chap hop genre, sort of out of main hip hop. Well, I mean, we've said Chuck D. Who else are we missing out on?
Well, I'd certainly, I mean, really, my, you know, my main interest is the almost the origins of hip hop, really, the old school sort of, you know, Grandmaster Flash and Cool Herc and that sort of thing. I quite enjoyed that. You know, I think the part of what I'm doing is trying to reinvigorate that, the original vibe, as it were, of hip hop, the sort of the fun aspects of it before it all went a little bit po-faced and then just went a little bit ludicrous. Completely. Not the ludicrous.
Yeah.
Right. Not ludicrous. Ludicrous.
Right, right, right.
So, yeah, certainly those sort of types. The, you know, the, I suppose the first two golden ages of hip-hop, whichever you may call them, so the very early age of Kool Herc and Flash and Bambaataa, then to the, I suppose, the second golden age of people like Pharcyde and well, I don't know, it was a Public Enemy, I suppose, would be part of the second wave and that sort of thing, and... Oh. Certainly a lot of things the Beastie Boys did as well. You know, well, pretty much everything the Beastie Boys did, we can't argue with.
Right.
Mm. Yeah.
So this is sort of anti-gangster rap. It's less about sort of the drive-by shooting and more about the drive-by constructive criticism.
Exactly. Or the occasional drive-by gloving. A drive-by Touché. Gloving. Or occasionally the drive-by sconing.
Well, there's nothing more strident than a random sconing.
That's true.
This is absolutely right.
Sounds delicious.
Yes. If you can catch so, it right. Well, yeah.
So, that being said, who's actually sitting on your turntables at the moment, on your gramophone turntables?
Who's on the gramophone? Well, at the moment I've got a bit of, I think it's a bit of Ronald Franco on there, who was an old... he was from the. Well, he was. He's been a few little films in the 30s, but he's. I think he's a precursor to chap hop as well, and to hip hop in a way. He's. There's a tremendous YouTube clip which you should look at. Is he spelled a Ronald Frankau, which is F R A N K A U, and there's a song he did called does called Let's Go Wild, and it's just a wonderful little piece of work. It's really rather marvelous, and well, it's probably a little bit not the sort of thing you could necessarily get away with these days, in a way. But I think for its time, it's rather marvellous. But mm-hmm. you see, I'd certainly recommend having a look at that.
All right.
Right on.
We'll definitely do that.
Well, as you have said there, I mean, you've indicated that it's probably not the sort of thing you could get away. I suppose that the nature of your music is that chap hop is both the future and the past of music. So there's an almost paradoxical evolution that something that was popular way back then, because it has been popular for quite some time, is popular again because it's so different. Do you, that sort of being factored in and the acknowledgement of that, do you think chap hop's got sort of a shelf life? Do you think that you're part of an evolution, that there's going to be a second generation of chap hop artists?
Well, possibly. I would hope so. Either that, or it's just I'm just going to be this strange little part of this strange little island of chap hop, which just floats around, generally not being noticed by most people most of the time, but occasionally people getting involved and what have you. But I mean, it's very much, as you said, it's this is a lot of the references are from a past that most people seem to have forgotten about. And I was talking to someone yesterday about, they were talking about sort of hip-hop vernacular and the sort of patois that's used. And in a way, a lot of the words I'm using are more of a patois than hip-hop language now, because everybody uses hip-hop language now.
This is
so
true.
It's almost, it's another sort of way of, you know, introducing a certain bits of language which people don't understand, which was, I suppose, what the reason for the original sort of vernacular of hip-hop was, that, you know, like the original patois of, say, market traders from the East End of London who'd create sort of Cockney rhyming slang in order for the police to not understand what they were on about when they were doing dodgy deals and things like that. Mm. It's often a way of excluding the people that don't want to get involved, you know. So so you have a certain amount of what would you call it? Sort of dedication to the cause that people would have in order to, you know, to be allowed, you know, not allowed in necessarily, but to welcome themselves in.
Mm.
Mm. Right on.
If that made any sense whatsoever.
Oh yeah, it did definitely. Yeah.
So by your suggestion, of course, chap hop is not sort of exclusionist or insular by its nature, but rather the very nature of it seems to be a little bit refined, so not everyone is going to get it, but you're certainly open for everyone to get a part of it, I guess.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think this is the reason why I wouldn't say deliberately stayed out of the mainstream, because you know, the mainstream hasn't necessarily invited me in. I've had certain aspects of people. I keep it getting invited along to the old, you know, TV talent shows and things like that, which you say, oh, I think your act will be really good. And I think, no, I think my act will be a disaster if the general public got a hold of it. I think they'd grow bored of the whole thing fairly swiftly. But I think it's one of those things that, you know, people like to feel that they've discovered you a bit. So they people feel they have a certain ownership of it. So therefore they feel more part of the whole thing, which I think is rather nice. And it's the fact that it's the sort of thing that not everybody's going to get makes people feel all warm and fuzzy inside with the fact that they think, yes, I get this and I'm enjoying it and I'm going to go with it.
Right.
Right.
That was definitely how it was for me, and I think it was definitely how it was for you, lads, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's like, you know, you share want to share it with your friends immediately. Like, have you heard something? Have you heard this before? You got to check this out.
You know, and I think most art kind of has that, whether it's music or fine art or whatever, you kind of have that, you know, that you like to discover things and you also like to be able to, you know, say that you get something. That,
right.
Yeah. You know.
Absolutely. Yeah. We all want to be that person that said, oh, I heard that years ago.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, tell me when I was there first. Oh, you liked it when it was cool.
Right.
Hopefully it's got enough legs to, I mean, I can, you know, there's numerous different directions it can go off in and things like that. I mean, I'm always planning on making the psychedelic album and then retiring from playing live altogether. And then you know, and then announcing gigs again and pretending I knew nothing of what I was talking about before. When you're on, you know, doing psychedelic albums, you don't generally know what on earth's going on anyway. So.
Well, there we go. We were at ground zero when Mr. B called it publicly.
Indeed.
I like this idea quite a bit.
Yes.
Not that I want to see you, you know, quit performing, but yeah.
Oh, no.
It's all real.
Yeah, why do you want a psychedelic album?
What's that?
I'm sorry, I've got to say that I do want a psychedelic album. There's no question which way or the other.
I will make sure that does happen at some point. Perhaps the next one will be that.
Well, I was kind of checking out some of your stuff on SoundCloud, and it sounds like you kind of aim for a little more EDM kind of angle on there, like your Acid Ragtime Radio Hour.
Yes, yes. Yeah. Well, that's all part of the album that's coming out next month. It's called Acid Ragtime Chapstep Volume 1.
Ah.
And this is my, the Mr. B, the Gentleman Selector persona. This is my DJ persona, if you like.
Perfect.
And it's, you know, I call it Acid Ragtime or Chapstep or Absinthe House.
Yeah, I like the Absinthe House.
Absinthe House, perhaps, yeah, I like
that. Or VDM, perhaps, which both, you know, vintage dance music, I'd say.
Right.
So, you know, which also, you know, contains the letters VD, which is... You know, that has nothing to do with anything particularly.
Right. Yeah.
not to draw attention to that, of course.
Of course. No. But it's, I mean, very much, you know, I that's another influence on me was the, you know, the original sort of acid house era that we had over here of, you know, the sort of from 1988 or so, the sort of rave scene that happened over here, which has sort of been, you know, sort of rather hidden underneath all the sort of the current EDM revival or whatever's happening at the moment. But so the album's very much a sort of very acid house, lots of Roland 303 and 808 sounds and that sort of thing, but also with lots of samples of old British comedy like Terry Thomas and Noel Coward. Noel Coward makes a little guest appearance there, just occasionally saying the word vegetables on a song called Vegetables. And so it's all rather silly, but you know, I've been DJing it out a little bit and that's been going down rather well, so it's just another little string to the bow. It's, again, one of the directions that chap hop can go off on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure.
It's a chap step. Chap step. Who knows?
Right. Yeah. I read somewhere, I can't remember where it was at, there was someone on Twitter that I saw that actually had said that he was going to try to branch it into, I believe, like hard rock or heavy metal music also.
Oh, that's right, yes. He was going to call it Chapcore, I think.
Yeah, Chapcore. That's what it was. Yep, that's what it was. That's fine.
Although I did, you know, I'd like, you know, I have done a few Aristo Rock numbers, as I like to call it, I think.
Right.
Which I've done my version of Crazy Nights by Kiss.
Right.
Which is always a favourite live until...
Oh, wow.
I could never do it too many times, though, because of the shrieking part of it. I tend to find, if I've got a few shows in a row to do, by the time I'm doing the second one, I can't do the shrieking anymore. I don't look after my voice, really. As I don't think any rappers really should.
Right.
Right, right.
But yes, I occasionally drag that one out when I think the voice is up to it.
Nice.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm sure that is quite a treat when you start that.
So there's Chapcore, and I'm aware that, one of the musicians of my acquaintance has decided to move into an area of music referred to as steampunk. So, I'm yet to actually hear what his...
catalogue is going to involve, but...
Who's doing steampunk?
The particular musician is known as Masashi Lethbridge. He's from California, as it turns out. So he's part Japanese, part African-American, and 100% cool guy. So he seems to be sort of originally a ska musician. He sort of plays a whole different catalogue of stuff, but he's indicated that he'd like to move in that area. So it'll be interesting to see what he comes up with.
Yeah, so there's a Montague Jacques Fromage, who's, I think he's from California as well, but he does what he calls steampunk funk.
Okay.
Yeah. Which is an interesting little little take on things. I think this seems to be in the whole steampunk thing. I think the fact that there isn't any specific steampunk music, as it were. It's not a sound. It's an aesthetic rather than a sound. So I think I found there's a couple of bands I've played with who have been sort of steampunk bands, and they said, "Yeah, we were just doing kind of strange sort of rock or ska things, and just we decided to put some goggles on, and suddenly we're getting loads of steampunk gear." So it's one of those things that people can go at it from whichever angle you like, really. Just it seems to do the job for a few people.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely,
yeah. Which that makes a lot of sense, because like you were saying, or kind of earlier, like hip-hop kind of did the same thing. It started as its own thing, and then it started kind of blending with other music, and over time to where you've obviously like Public Enemy and Anthrax or Run DMC and Aerosmith with the rock thing, and then
the era of rock rap,
right? Well, I was going with
that's what these
good rock rap, but
these things can not always end up working out
right.
But, there's always aspects of it that work out well,
right?
But I think that's I'm very kind of anti-purist myself. I'm lots of people, I'm always been one for bastardizing things. That's what music's there for, really.
Right Well, and again, that's...
I always think that I would never make an album that just contained one sort of particular type of music. I often find it confusing why all bands aren't just making one classical track and then one reggae track and then one dance music track or something like that.
Sure.
Right.
Because surely music's there to be all music's there to be enjoyed. So and that's the thing. I'm often found guilty of listening to my own music too much, but I always think, but that's why I make music, because I want something to listen to.
Right. Yeah.
Absolutely.
It's
sort of bizarre, and just picking up on that, you just sort of reminded me the most intriguing piece of trivia that I know. I believe it was the Bon Scott, the original lead singer from AC/DC, his favourite musician was Dionne Warwick. So probably is out there, as you can probably get, but it is a really good point that if you are a musician, you should be able to recognize what is good in a variety of styles and not be too sort of landlocked within one. So bravo, sir, for making the call.
Well, I often find that with especially with things like being a part of a scene, I've done some bits of music before when you end up being sort of gradually pigeonholed into a scene, and it just completely squashes the creativity of what you're doing in a way. So I suppose that's a good thing about steampunk, is that you musically you can kind of go anywhere with it, really.
Right. True. Yeah.
Whereas I'd done some dance music before and ended up sort of as part of the what you might call the breakbeat scene and that sort of thing from the sort of mid to late 90s, and then I just realized that I couldn't, I think I just wasn't enough of a producer to create the correct sounds which were needed at that particular time in that particular genre for people to actually want to listen to it anymore. So I thought, this is just silly. So I think the best thing to do is just create your own genre, and then you can do what you want with it. And no one can accuse you of not sounding correct, because if it was your idea in the first place, then there's nothing they can do about it.
Right. Yeah.
Now, I have to ask you, sir, with that in mind, leading up into sort of chap hop, at the time that you're actually experimenting with other sounds as a musician, was the decision to actually sort of head towards chap hop, was it something that had been building up over time, or was it just one day, no, this is it, chap hop, bam, we're going?
Well, the idea of chap hop and things like that had been in my head for a number of years, I think, really. But being a musician, I'd never really got around to doing anything about it until for a while. But it was sort of a culmination of lots of other things I'd done, because I'd been in a sort of hip-hop band doing more straight-up hip-hop. And then I was also in this sort of dandy punk band that we called it called the Schooner Boys. But I didn't write any of the stuff for them. But we did had songs called Decanter Riot. We just sort of sing punk songs about drinking sherry and that sort of thing.
Right.
And generally misbehaving. And then I sort of got into playing the banjolele and around about the turn of the century. And so I just decided to bring the whole thing together. And just, I think I did, I recorded one song called A Piece of My Mind, which is the video for. And then someone immediately, I put it up on a MySpace page back in those days. Mm-hmm. And someone immediately got in touch with me and said, can you come and play at a festival? So I thought, I'd best write a few more songs then. So, yes, I had to get myself, desperately had to scrabble myself a little set together. And then it went rather well. So I thought, okay, this might work. Hmm. And it's sort of plodded itself along from then, really.
So going back to the banjolele, how did you decide on playing that?
Well, that was another happy accident, really. That was I was looking for a present for my godson's second or third birthday or something like that, and I saw this ukulele for about 13 quid in a shop somewhere, and I sort of thought, oh, well, I can give him that, and he can smash it up and that sort of thing. And so I went into the shop, and the chap tuned it up and played a couple of chords. And I immediately thought, well, I'm having that. That's mine. So, so unfortunately, my godson never got a present because I'd nicked it for myself. And then so it started, all the times before, I just played various instruments and I'd always written my own songs and things like that on them. But the ukulele, I suddenly thought, this is going to be in my own little jukebox. So I just decided to learn lots of, you know, my favourite songs and things like that by other people. And suddenly, you know, you realise after it being far too late that that's the best way of learning how to learn instruments and things like that, rather than making it all up yourself, is listen to what other people have done and learn their stuff. So it became my own little sort of private jukebox, really. And then I moved down to Brighton from London, and with a couple of friends who were down here, started a little band called Rock Onik and Bob. And we just did sort of silly, you know, unexpected cover versions on ukuleles, which is, we're probably the sort of band that are fairly ubiquitous now, but... I think after I started playing the ukulele, I bought a banjolele because I just thought it sounded more silly. And it was the instrument that George Formby used to use, who was an old music hall comic and a huge film star in the 40s and 50s over here. But so I always liked the sound of that. So it's just a sort of sillier sounding ukulele, really.
Ah. Mm. Yeah, I was wondering, you know, because when you were talking about the ukulele, that's kind of, I was going to ask you if you had started on the banjo or the ukulele, so you already answered that for me. But
Yes. Well, I mean, as a musical instrument, it's just a ukulele, really, but it's just got the banjo drum and the banjo sound. So
right.
It's
a bit more, it's like a more twangy ukulele.
Now, is it any more difficult to play than either instrument?
No, it's just... Probably, well, I imagine it's easier to play than the banjo. I've never played the banjo, actually, to be honest with you. So I've no idea how that... But that always looks tricky. Perhaps it's easy, but it always looks tricky.
Yeah, yeah. I actually...
Ukulele.
Ukulele
is quite simple.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm not trying to step all over you here.
No, quite. Do carry on.
Because I looked around online because I was just curious about, the difficulty of playing it versus, you know, because I've known a few people that have played banjo, and they've said that it is fairly difficult to play.
It's incredibly hard to play.
And looking around online, it seems to be like split as far as whether it is or it is not harder to play. So, you know, the banjolele, that is. So, yes. Yeah.
Well, I'd say, you know, if, basically it's played as if it was a ukulele, right? It's the same four strings and the same tuning as a ukulele. So it's, I'd say it's probably an awful lot easier than a banjo.
Okay. Fair enough.
Well, there you go.
Yes, I think.
Well, not question, sir. Any other musical instruments that you can actually include as a string to the bow, so to speak?
Well, I do. I mean, I do play a few numbers now live off when I get the chance on the piano, but I wouldn't call myself a pianist. I would say I was a keyboard player. Mm-hmm. So I have been a keyboard player in bands before, but never a pianist. A keyboard player, you can play with, you know, you can play some chords on the right hand and use my left hand strictly. Index finger, plonk, plonk, plonk. That's about the strength of it. But you can just about get away with it if you try and, you know, muck about enough. So I do tend to play a few little, kind of ballads, I suppose you'd call them in a way. There's one on Can't Stop, Shan't Stop, a piano song called Doesn't Pay to Turn Up Late to an Orgy. So, yes, there's things like that.
They always say with those circumstances, neatest correct entry wins, I believe. So
yeah, well, there you go. Yes, absolutely right. But no, I do play. I play. you know, having a misspent youth being in various bands, so I played, you know, whenever the drummer went off to use the toilet, I'd have a go on the drums. So I play the drums a bit, and bass and guitar and keyboards, and I play the trombone slightly, but really badly. I foolishly used it live sometimes, and at the time, I remember seeing, you know, at the time I played a show at the Royal Albert Hall in London, but it was in the Elgar room, which is not the main bit. But I remember playing my little, I've got a soprano trombone or a slide trumpet, so it's like a mini trombone, which is rather good fun. But, you know, I was playing it, and I was actually thinking at the time, thinking, this is good, I'm hitting the notes, and it's sounding really good. And then somebody posted a video on YouTube of it, and I realised that that wasn't the case at all. It was nothing like it. It sounded absolutely dreadful. So,
right.
I either have to just try and learn.
Or just stay away from YouTube videos.
Perhaps, yes.
Also
yeah.
True.
Yeah. Well, to be fair, I think sort of the trombone is unfairly saddled with sort of the name trombone. So they always say that, you know, they're a bad trombonist. But to be fair, most trombonists play badly. So... all this is a trumpet with a paperclip. So
I wish we had a sad trombone too much joke right now.
That's very comforting. Thank you very much,
Austin.
Now, I've got to ask, you've talked about sort of the playing some of the festival circuit, and you've done a couple of festivals, and you've done a couple of gigs sort of all over the place. Where do you find that your biggest audiences are outside the UK?
Hard to say, really. I mean, I've often, yes, I've played in the States a couple of times, and I've played around parts of Europe. Obviously, sometimes, oddly, I went down really, really well in Paris, and most people in Paris are, you know, quite fervently anti-English speaking. You know, they don't like to be, you know,
right.
Very few people in Paris actually learn how to speak English. Mm-hmm. Obviously, we're very lazy being English speakers that, you know, we go around the world and expect everybody else to speak English.
Yep.
But oddly, I went down very well in Paris, which I couldn't quite understand. But there you go. But I think, I mean, I'd say the festival circuit, you know, in the UK has been very good to me, generally speaking. And I tend to get a lot of people along to those shows, which is always fun. And then that tends to filter through to various other things. But yeah, it's been nice to get the chance to do a few more things. Further afield and that sort of thing.
Right.
It would be great to actually have you sort of show up in Australia. I know that it's probably not likely to happen anytime soon. The last couple of English that seem to have set up residence here have sort of become, you know, members here due to our rather archaic penal system. So I imagine we've had sort of European tourism since, but, you know.
Yes, yes. Well, I think it would be nice. I mean, there's all, of course, there's the sort of the Adelaide Fringe and the Melbourne Comedy Festival. Or I can't remember which round, but there's a cabaret festival and a comedy festival. I know a lot of people I know come over and do the Adelaide Fringe and the Melbourne Fringe after each other in sort of January and February.
Now, you've done Edinburgh before as well, haven't you?
I've done it for the last few years, actually, yes.
Yes.
And that's always great fun. It's always very good. And slightly, you know, it's a bit of a killer. I did, you know, you tend to, as I did last year, this year I decided I had to take the decision to take it slightly easy this year because the year before I'd got home and my wife made me a lovely lunch for when I got back, and I'd been up there for a couple of weeks, and she put the food in front of me and I'd said, I'm sorry, I can't eat this, I'm going to have to go to bed. And she was a little bit annoyed, but luckily for me, I spent the next 2 days being sick, so I got away with it. She wasn't annoyed before because I was just violently ill for about 2 days, and my body had just said, "All right, have you finished Edinburgh now? Have you? Right, okay, let's be very, very ill."
Yes, well, apparently the food in Edinburgh does that to everyone anyway. So
you can never have too little haggis.
if it's not fried, it's not inside.
Exactly. Well, obviously there was the recent independence referendum and things like that, and there was the whole talk about, you know, what was going to be the, you know, I think the Bank of England was saying you can't use the pound, so I think the deep fried Mars bar was going to actually be a unit of currency, I think, for a while, but for some reason they decided not to leave the union. So there you go. They've turned around.
As an American, I probably shouldn't be laughing at the deep-fried Mars bar thing. Yeah. I'm actually surprised we don't, you know,
have that as currency.
Yeah.
You probably do have it in the US. It's probably sold as a Walmart in like a tube or something.
It's probably sold as like diet food.
Yeah,
honestly.
That's probably true.
Yeah, probably part of an offer. You know, you buy three and they end up like kicking in on your triple bypass.
That's a good deal.
That's a hell of a deal.
It is.
So, gentlemen, I was going to ask this, and I was actually thinking about sort of Mr. B's effect, his knock-on effect for popular culture, sort of us being sort of worldly gents. I mean, Tony and Brian, sort of you're fairly worldly gents. You've seen everything that life has to throw at you, and you've still managed to be upstanding gentlemen.
Wow.
Admittedly, I'm also thusly encumbered, but having sort of listened to Mr. B's tunes and seen the way he actually conducts himself, I realise I've got a long way to go. So if it'd be okay with you, I'm going to ask Mr. B a few chap questions. Let's call them chap or not questions. Would you be okay with that, Mr. B?
I'll give it my best shot, sir.
Okay. First question.
For starters, I'm very pleased that you should suggest that I've had some kind of knock-on effect on popular culture. That's rather nice of you to say, sir.
Look, you absolutely have. You've put a fold in my brain that has not only become deeply entrenched, it's been creased and ironed and folded neatly in there.
Excellent. I like that. Very good.
And currently, you're the only one with a mustache wax. So,
also true.
You know.
Perhaps, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
My Vegemite wax really contains that. Anyway, moving on.
Not ours is deep fried, so you know.
Yeah.
It certainly is better than eating it. Anyway, so yes, the first question, chivalry versus feminism. Now, where does a chap stand in this? I mean, for me, opening doors and is sort of a polite way of doing things, but are opening doors and curtsies just symbols of oppression or where does the whole chap ideology stand on this?
Well, I mean, I would suggest holding doors open shouldn't be exclusively used just for ladies. It's you know, I'd like to think if somebody was, this is the whole, you know, the debate I think is less holding open for ladies. It's more how far away should somebody be in order for you to hold the door open?
Right.
That's more of a concern, really, for any chap, I'd say. You know, if someone's 20 yards away, you know, how long do you wait holding the door open? This is probably a bit of a sort of Seinfeld debate that's probably been had. But, you know, how long do you hold the door open for? And I would suggest it's, you know, chivalry isn't, you know, should be just, it's for everybody, I would suggest. So it's not necessarily just for ladies. I mean, not that I've seen many chaps curtsying, that said.
No.
But the whole curtsy for me thing was actually from, I played a show in the northeast of England, in a place called Saltdean, near Newcastle, and there was a young lady there who, I think I was signing some CDs and that sort of thing, and she came up to me and she curtsied, and she said, I said, oh, that's very nice of you to curtsy. She went, I'm really sorry, I didn't know what to do, I've never met anyone posh before. So, it was an entirely voluntary thing that she did, and so that's why I came up with the song Curtsy For Me. But it was also, I don't know if it came across, but it was almost, the Curtsy For Me thing was almost my sort of little taking the mick out of rather sexist hip-hop tunes when, you know, the chap may be talking about whatever he wishes for the lady to do for him, whereas, you know, curtsying is fine, you know, you don't have to do anything else, if you get my drift.
Right.
Yes.
Well, you know, obviously that's for another time.
Well, second base, obviously a curtsy is appropriate.
Exactly, yes. Curtsy, you know, if you get a curtsy, you think, okay, well, maybe in here.
You heard it here first, folks.
You heard it here first.
Yeah.
Curtsy, yeah, yes.
I hope everyone's writing this down. Now, the second question, a fashion question.
Righto.
Do you think spats would be a lot more popular with the current fashion industry if they had a less confrontational name? I thought we should actually look at sort of going back to describing them as gaiters, but really the only place for gaiters in fashion seems to be on like golf shirts and that sort of thing. So
yes.
What are your thoughts, sir? And when is the appropriate time to wear a set of spats?
Spats is not... I have to say, spats isn't a speciality of mine. They aren't a speciality of mine, I have to say. Although, I think the word spats is rather good. It's rather I think it would still stand as a fairly jazzy little word. But yes, appropriate time to wear spats. I, you know, to be honest with you, I've got a pair of spats and I hardly ever wear them, to be honest with you. I occasionally put galoshes on. Yeah, it needs to be. Galoshes. With, you know, if you have spats and galoshes, then basically you don't really need to wear shoes at all. Maybe that would be it. Hmm. Just get rid of the shoe.
There we go. Another important detail there. Now, the real one for me, and this I absolutely have to ask because I have a cousin, Rebecca, big shout out to her, who is an absolute devoted fan of you, who's Thank just you. Found herself back in the single life again, and she Ooh. Wants to know about chaps and romance. Now, how does a modern chap woo the ladies?
Well, you know, hold on.
What are the standard chat-up lines?
Let me jump in real quick. Make sure you point out the curtsying is appropriate for the second for second base to her.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Okay, sorry, cover we that. Should draw attention to that.
Right.
But I suppose what is the polite way to close the deal or not so much close the deal, but force an effective... no, we'll go with close the deal. I can't go with the deal.
Yeah, well, forcing sounds weird.
Suggest, I mean, it's,
yeah.
I think one must just do one's best when taking a lady out for dinner and things like that. And one should be. I mean, obviously, I did say that chivalry is for everybody, but it still works in a you know, one of those situations, really, in a romantic situation. So I think being chivalrous, it just shows that you're a nice person, really. A decent chap. Obviously, not all the ladies like a nice person. Obviously, you know, this is another debate for another time again, but obviously, ladies rather like a bounder. And that sort of thing. So yeah. Occasionally you could be a bit of a cad and the ladies rather enjoy that sort of thing. But that's, unfortunately, I'm rather not so good at being a cad, really. But obviously, I think, you know, the thing is, if you get the chance to get them back home, the smoking jacket, a couple of little flutes and some champagne does the job, I would have thought. I mean, you know, gin, as much gin as possible probably does the job, really, more than anything.
Works every chivalrous. Time.
Apply them with gin.
I was about to say, that's certainly going to get you beyond the curtsy stage.
Perhaps, yes, indeed. But once the curtsy's occurred, I mean, you know, pretty much that's, you know, job done.
It's game on.
It's already game on.
Oh, good Lord. Okay, so
bend at the knee, then...
just taken something very proper and appropriate and just
it's kind of
demolished
what we,
it.
What
yeah.
we do.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Rather than taking a little bit
No,
less.
Yes.
Gentlemen, I think this is why we can't have nice things.
Quite right, yes.
Is there sort of an opening line? Like if I'm a sort of, you know, decked out my fine, so I'm feeling the need for tweed, as it were, sort of I've got my brogues polished into a high gloss, so sort of rocking my sporties Argyle, and I meet a lady that I want to make an impression upon first off. What should I actually be pushing in my buttonhole? Because I know that carnations look a little bit cheap and tawdry. Obviously, an orchid is completely wrong with sort of like the muted colours of you know, Argyle and tweed. So what can I do to improve on my appearance before I off to woo? Admittedly, once I get permission from my wife to do so.
Of course, yes, we must all get that.
Hey, I'm sorry, real quick. I had just written down divorce papers to show to Tony. Sorry, I didn't mean to.
You can make a nice flower out of it or something.
Yeah.
Well, I'd say for starters, you know, if you're serious about being a chap and she's serious about dating a chap, then one thing to do is never match the tie and the pocket square. That's always an important thing, and something which is a little known fact. It's one of the things you always notice if you meet another chap and they've got a matching tie and pocket square. You think, you've not quite done your homework there, young man. Mm-hmm. Whereas, they should complement each other, not clash, but the tie and the pocket square should always be different. Yes. I would suggest. And as far as the buttonhole goes, I mean, perhaps try a bit of sparkle. There's nothing wrong with that. Perhaps your brooch. You know, yes, this does work. This can happen. I've seen it done to good effect, so this can happen. The occasional brooch, rather than perhaps a flower, can do the job.
I had never considered a brooch, and indeed a banjolele brooch would be sort of a welcome addition to sort indeed. Of
I do actually have a banjolele brooch, oddly enough.
I know. I have actually been eyeing it with a great deal of desire in my heart. So I'm very jealous there, sir. So.
Get your restraining order ready.
Yes, we don't be in a situation where I'm tied to a chair going, just take it! Just take the brooch!
Oh, no. English boy got himself a purdy mouth. Anyway.
A purdy brooch.
Purdy brooch.
Yes. Moving swiftly on.
Yes.
So, gentlemen, you had some questions as well.
I actually have my daughter, she's 9, she saw the Songs for Acid Edward video on YouTube, and she suddenly became a huge fan of yours, right?
Excellent.
Yes. So I have 3 questions from her that she would like me to ask you.
Splendid.
One of them, and I know you guys worked this out, but she wants to know, why does Professor Elemental hate you?
Well, I don't. I think it was more, it's just, you know, he had a bit of a bee in his bonnet about the whole thing. Bless him. I think a lot of the time he was doing shows and people were thinking that he was me and that sort of thing, which just, you know, does happen from time to time. Occasionally people will come up to my shows and go, I love that cup of tea song you did. Why didn't you do that? And I will have to tell them that's not me, that's him.
Right.
But we did early on, oddly, even though we live in the same city, we were completely unaware of each other for about the first year of when we were doing this.
Really?
Someone else from another band he said, oh, have you heard of Professor Elemental? I said, no. And he said, well, have a look at his video. So I had a look and thought, oh, dear. And then I thought, oh, dear, look at how many hits he's had on YouTube. That's far too many. we did actually meet early on, oddly enough, at a Public Enemy gig in Brixton, in London. Nice. And, you know, we had a chat and got on rather well. But then we didn't see each other for maybe a year and a half. And I think in that time, he had lots of people in his ears sort of saying, well, what about this Mr. B? And what about this Mr. B? So... And then we did meet up afterwards again, and after he'd done the whole fighting trousers thing, and he said, you know, as an MC, he'd always wanted to do a diss song, and I was the only logical person that had actually turned up in his lifetime to whom he could do a diss song.
Mm.
So that's how it happened, really. But we've called a chap hot Armistice now, so we're all chums again.
Yeah. Well, you sort of had him in the Just Like a Chap clip, and you did the duel as well, which I've got a recording of.
That's right, yes.
Which I thought was absolutely fantastic. It's probably one of the greatest tracks I've ever heard.
Yeah.
I really enjoyed it.
Yes, it was rather good fun. Because it did the job. Well, we had a couple of battles here and there. Oddly enough, that show in Paris was a battle between myself and Professor Elemental, which must have just made no sense to people whatsoever, but they seemed to enjoy themselves. And they turned the whole stage into a boxing ring, and they made these wooden cutouts of Victorian boxers at the back. It was really rather splendidly done. And but yeah, I'm sure they'd have absolutely no idea what we're on about, but they seem to whoop and cheer enough.
Right.
Yes.
She would also like to know, have you ever seen the Queen?
I've ever seen the Queen.
Yes.
No, but I think my mother's did meet the Queen Mother when she was still alive. But oddly, my mum was working in a hospital, and I think they were having a visit from the Queen Mother, and my mum I think she was just a receptionist at the time or something like that, and said the Queen Mother just got out of the car and just made a beeline straight for my mum, who was just suddenly going, oh, it was another, you know, do I curtsy sort of situation. Very similar,
right,
I imagine,
second
to
base.
The one I had in Saltley. And the Queen's Mother just went straight up to my mum and started chatting to her and things like that. And my mum's going, sort of, she said apparently she was all bouncing up and down trying to work out whether she was should be curtsying or saying what to her and that sort of thing. So she panicked slightly. But I've never actually seen the Queen myself.
Right. And the last question, and bless her little 9-year-old heart, it's very insightful. It's, what's your favourite song to perform?
Oh, I say.
Yeah.
It's probably Songs for Acid Edward.
Yeah.
Actually, certainly over here, because of the, you know, the references to the old rave culture of you know, the largely sort of UK-based stuff, it always saves the show for me. If things aren't going that well, I mean, they usually go, not say that they don't usually go well, but sometimes if I think these people need a bit of pepping up, I'll, you know, Acid Edward usually does the job. And I tend to play it at the end of the show, which is nice because it means people leave on a high. So even if they've been bored stiff for most of the gig, that one, they usually go, oh, that was great. That one tune I heard at the end. So if you leave them with that one, it's the whole going out on the high thing.
Hmm, right on.
Well, occasionally, but then people ask for an encore, and then I have to go back and do one that they go, okay, yeah, we're finished now, thanks. Yeah, we're happy to go now, thanks. We've done that.
Well, once you've heard Good Life played on a banjolele, I mean, that's it. That's a night for me.
Yeah.
Exactly, yes. This is it. This is it.
Yeah. What about you, Brian?
Most of mine I've either asked or whatever. I do have one question that's I saw on your Facebook page. There was a T-shirt of you with like a big boombox on it. Is that going to be available on your store at any time?
I'll tell you what, it's available, but it's from a... so I don't actually do those, deal with the sale of those myself, because obviously I couldn't, officially be seen as be selling such items. I sell strictly ties and cufflinks and moustache wax, as you well know.
Of course,
but, you can't sell your hands of T-shirts.
Yes, of course.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Or, I would have to call them undershirts.
Yeah.
Yes. Undershirts, correct.
But there's a company called, what they called, it's dizzyjam.com, and they're based in Wales, and they basically make the T-shirts to order. So they've got the designs on there, and there's the Mr. B, the Gentleman Rhymer Square logo, and then the Acid Ragtime sort of moustache smiley logo ones. So you just go on there, and you choose whatever colour T-shirt you want, what colour print you want, and they make them to order.
Oh, okay.
So if you wish for one, do go on there. Unfortunately, I can't send them out myself because it's not my company.
Ah,
right.
But I get a little, a pound or something like that for each one sold.
You get a little taste of it, right?
Exactly.
That's right. May not be your company, but we've been spoiled enough with your company tonight, sir. So thank you for that. Or tomorrow, or wherever you are.
Yeah.
Wherever we're all at.
Yeah, we're dealing with multiple days.
I've actually got a lovely blue sky. It's been raining all morning, but it's sort of 10 to 6 in the evening now, and it's a lovely blue sky. It's looking rather nice down here. I don't know what the weather's like over here. This is it. See, I'm from England. I have to talk about the weather.
Right.
In Australia, it is currently pitch black, and it's about 30 degrees Celsius here. So it's dark. It's hot. It's everything that I am currently not.
Well, it's damp and cold here, so make your own jokes as needed.
Exactly.
Well, where about you, chaps? Then where are you based over here?
We're in the United States. We're in Michigan.
Ah, right. So.
Yeah. The Mitten State.
Yeah.
Yes, you are.
Yeah. Yeah, it's about 1 o'clock and damp and cold, which is pretty standard for around here.
Yeah.
Splendid. That sounds
Oh, excuse me. I have to ask, you actually did mention, not to dwell too much on Vic's Vapor Rub, the cough wasn't for effect or anything. It just was a real cough. We'll establish that now. With regards to the moustache wax, I've got to ask you, pomade versus wax, should pomade ever be used as a moustache wax?
Interesting. A little confession here is I hardly ever actually use moustache wax. I tend to just wake up in the morning and the moustache is just ready for action, really.
Unluckily,
genetically somehow, that's the one genetically... part of me genetically that I'm pleased with.
Yeah, it's well trained.
My moustache has just grown and it does my bidding. It can go down or up. It's very malleable. But, I think
ladies,
yes, of course, yes. And I do. That's the thing. I do. A lot of ladies do tend to want to have a little go on the moustache, as it were. They want to, ladies want to touch it
and then curtsy.
Then curtsy,
as they say, and then curtsy. But I do have to tell them that it is real because a number of ladies I found it early on. That you must explain that the moustache is real, because I did fairly early on in Mr. B's career, a young lady did say, "Oh, can I have a little go on your moustache?" And I said, "Of course, yes." And she proceeded to try and rip the thing off in one go, which she hurt quite a lot.
Yeah, I would admit.
She was duly chastised, and I made it my mission then to make sure that people must know that it is real, even though they're not. Watching you or being a fan for a while, and they still don't believe it's actually real. I say it's perfectly simple. Just, if I'm a man, if I don't show my upper lip, a moustache grows. It's simply not shaving. That's all I've done, has been not shaving. But I think if a pomade, whatever makes the moustache look good, is fine. I wouldn't, you know, I don't want to be, you know, telling people how to go about their business and that sort of thing. Although I must tell people that the Victor's Vapor, the moustache wax, is actually a good moustache wax as well. It's not just a gag. Because I have put up on Facebook and things like that, you know, about it being available on the website and things like that. And I think I've had a total of zero sales of it so far. So I think people just think, oh, it's just a tin of nonsense. But it's actually a very nice, it's very good medium hold moustache wax anyway. And it smells rather nice.
Well, I do actually ask, what was the base wax for it? Was it Canuba or beeswax?
I'm not exactly sure, to be honest, because I have a chap that makes it for me. That, you know, there's a professor type that does it for me, so I don't actually... I'm not in the lab myself, you know, mixing things up, unfortunately. I'm assuming it's beeswax, I think. And I would hope it's beeswax, because obviously my other wax is called Mr. Beeswax. So,
oh, touche.
Yeah.
Indeed, touche. You know, the original nice sandalwood-scented moustache wax I do is just called Mr. Beeswax. It was just, you know, ooh, it was too simple. It was too easy. It was far too easy.
You have to.
Seriously, anything with sandalwood, that's the reason that you grow a moustache. Ladies, obviously... Indeed. You're going to feel a little bit disappointed by this one. So now with the moustache growing, because like I have grown the moustache before, and like unfortunately mine tends to, I look like an ethnic 1970s porn extra, to be completely frank. It's something I'm not overly proud of. What advice can you give for a little bit of upper lip manscaping?
I would say, you know, stick with it. You know, that's the thing, is that I think once the moustache at the sides has grown long enough to at least twizzle between your fingers, things will start to make sense. Everything will start, because I know people that have often very thin moustache hair, but if you stick at it, it will grow long enough, and then you can buff it up with a bit of wax and that sort of thing. I mean, obviously you have to have the moustache to suit your hair or your face or what have you, but I'd say, you know, stick with it. Let it grow to the point when you can twirl it, and then everything will fall into place. And usually you'll find that, you know, should you be somebody who generally wears a T-shirt and jeans and things like that, once you've got the twirled moustache, you'll find yourself being drawn to the tie section of a store rather than the T-shirt section and things like that. Things tend to rather fall into place around the moustache. It's quite a magical little item.
I must admit, I have been sort of flirting with an ascot recently, so with sort of not all the time, it's a little bit difficult to sort of pass off with a bowling shirt or a T-shirt, but yeah, certainly
I disagree.
When I actually have been, well, yeah, you can't go into a commitment with an ascot lightheartedly. I don't think it's very serious business.
Yeah,
of course. You'll realise these things, you know, as you say, you couldn't wear it with a T-shirt. Just wouldn't look slightly like you would perhaps. You know, ill somehow.
Right. Well, that whole style of dressing is something that shouldn't be gone into lightly, you know.
But I think it's, you know, I think people actually appreciate it, because, you know, this is how I dress day to day. And I think, generally speaking, I've never had abuse for it anyway. But, you know, usually people just go, nice moustache, or I like it. You know, you look, you know, I think I had someone just stood on the platform of Oxford Circus on London Underground station a while back, and this old, sort of slightly dishevelled looking chap, perhaps in his 50s, sort of longish grey hair, just walked past me and stopped right in front of me and just pointed and said, "You look great." And then just carried on. So I thought, okay, yeah, this is the sort of thing that happens. So
it's working.
It's really rather nice.
Yeah, exactly.
You have to be, you know, and that's the thing. And I also find, in a way, it's made me a better person, because often I would walk down the street, and if you see someone who you think looks a bit of an idiot or a hipster or something like that, you'd go, God, look at them. Whereas I think, you know, I have to stop myself and think, you've got a ridiculous moustache. Don't start casting aspersions on others. when you yourself could be that person that probably a lot of people are looking at and going, look at that dick.
Welcome to Chap Hop After Dark. Yes, that's right. Yeah, Mr. B said dick.
I'm sorry about that. I can only apologise for everybody out there. I will never say it again. Well, maybe I will. Only if I've got a friend.
Don't worry, sir. You're English. We've spoken to Canadians before. They're more used to apologising than you, sir. So
it's very true.
Carry on. Let your dick fly free. Anyway,
as I was going to ask, regarding the fashion and indeed the deportment side of things, I must admit, and I do have a confession, that also with regards to the somewhat surly attitude, indeed my nom de guerre, as it was on Twitter, actually has me down as Angry Oz. Listening to your music, I've got to tell you, and particularly recently, the Tweed album has done a great deal for me holding sort of the more negative and aggressive, nasty parts of my personality in check and not being judgmental and casting aspersions, particularly the song Nick Nakatori. That I've never actually come across a song that's actually held me at bay so much. And at the same time, it actually makes me smile when I'm listening to it. So without a deal, without a lie, sir, you know, kudos to you. You're definitely the real article. So massive respect.
Thank you, old chap. And it's very nice to know that I can make people smile and hold them at bay at the same time.
Well, there you go.
I'm just shocked something holds you at bay, Oz.
Yes. I'm not sure if that's something I'll put on a poster, though.
No, that's fine.
It holds me at bay. It's not something you come along to the show and be held at bay.
I don't know, maybe if you had, like, you know, Bruce Banner on there or something, you know, maybe. Like it keeps him from turning into Hulk. So yeah.
Perhaps, yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Again, maybe that's the job for perhaps the forthcoming psychedelic album, maybe.
Ready to rage, try beige.
Yeah, very good.
Oh,
geez.
Yes. Oh, man.
Well, I did actually say, yeah, talking of poster quotes, I did actually use there's oddly, a Brighton magazine that used the term, which I actually used on a poster, which was bafflingly popular, I think they said. I thought that's quite a nice little backhanded non-compliment to use on a poster.
You know, popular. I think that's, you know, that's what we're striving for.
Yeah.
You know?
Yes, of course.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If we got a review of us and, you know, they said we were bafflingly popular, I'd be all over it too.
It'd be framed, yes. I think.
We're not for it sure if they're fantastic, but they're certainly here.
Yeah,
exactly. Exactly. I was like, I think it was Vice magazine actually. They seem to have, a couple of times now, referenced me as far as if they, I mean, they usually, you know, they tend to just sort of be the magazine for hating things, and I think they were reviewing some kind of vintage wedding show or something like that, and they used the sort of the pseudo insult of these look like the sort of people that would have a VIP pass for a Mr. B the Gentleman Rhymer concert. And I just thought, wow, they actually think that I do shows that actually would merit a VIP pass. I turn up at the pub, I'll be on. Vice magazine actually think I do gigs that require VIP passes, so I was rather pleased with that one.
Velvet robes and all that.
Right, and well, we know how indeed. You get into the VIP. Curtsy. Yeah.
Of course.
Oh, man. Well, Oz, do you have anything else? We've taken up hour of his time here.
One final one. Where does Chap Hop Fashion stand on the polka dot?
On the polka dot? Well, I'd say, certainly in the, with the correct accessory, as in a polka dot, you can have a polka dot cravat and a polka dot pocket square. Absolutely fine. Lovely. Polka dot shirt, though, not so sure.
Mm-hmm.
And certainly polka dot trousers I would probably forego. An entire polka dot suit, probably not the best idea, unless you're trying to do a sort of Prince in 1988 type of thing. But, you know, that's been in
love. Well, obviously, you're talking about not the Prince of Wales, you're talking about sort of the musician
Prince.
The Prince of Minnesota.
I'm sure the Prince of Wales has a number of polka dot pocket squares, I would think. I'll be almost certain. I'm sure you'd be able to find a it would be a subtle polka dot, be a very small polka dot.
Mm.
But I'm sure the Prince of Wales would probably have a number of polka dot pocket squares coming out of his breast pocket, I would have thought.
I got to ask, what about polka dot socks? Because I love socks.
Yes, well, actually, no, I think I've got some polka dot socks.
Perfect.
So, yeah, socks are usually a bit of a free-for-all, I find. You know, it's...
Amen.
I've actually... I've been meaning to... There's a company called Foot Cardigan who are a sock subscription service.
I love the name.
Yes. And they basically... you subscribe to them, and every month they send you a pair of socks. You don't necessarily choose what they are. They just have a certain design, and they send them out to everyone. And they're planning on doing a Mr. B one, but they've been rather slow. as often is the case, you know, the contact becomes rather sparse.
Right.
But I had Mr. B sock.
I had no idea my mother had an internet-based business. That's. I'm surprised. Now you were talking. I absolutely will, sir. She'll probably curtsy for you. Now, I do have to ask. You were talking about the difference between the tie and the pocket square. Paisley with stripes, paisley with anything else. What's the deal there? Because I know paisley is a very big thing sort of within a chap's wardrobe.
Well, yes. I mean, again, you know, paisley on the pocket square or on the... I don't tend to go for... I would never generally go for a paisley tie, but I would certainly go for a paisley cravat, because a cravat is similar sort of things to the pocket square. It's a slightly more ruffled, sort of loose thing that you'd wear. But yeah, certainly a bit of paisley does the job. Absolutely. I think I've got a paisley pocket square in my jacket at the moment. I'm not wearing it because I'm just sat at home, but it's on the hanger and ready to go for when I go out.
Absolutely, it should be.
You're quite right.
Right.
Well, gentlemen, any other questions of Mr. B?
I think we covered everything we wanted to cover.
Mm-hmm. Splendid.
Besides showering in adoration.
Well, go on with you. No.
So, you said the new album comes out next month?
Yes. To download is out on the 10th of November.
Okay.
And it'll be available. I may make it available from on CD, which has got an extra track called Monty's Acid, which is a sort of strange swung sort of acid house dubstep version of the Monty Python theme.
Oh, nice.
So that's exclusively on the CD.
Oh, nice.
So that's from, I'll be available from gentlemanrhymer.com then. And I'm going to try and get some videos made and that sort of thing. But it's obviously, because it's more, I'm only actually sort of vocalising on about three of the tunes. The rest of them are all sort of, you know, the odd sample here and there and that sort of thing, and lots of squelchy noises. So it's a slightly different thing, but hopefully people enjoy it. I mean, the reviews so far have been great, particularly, oddly, from a lot of my friends who tend to be very, you know, old friends who tend to be kind of com-si, com-sa, as far as Mr. B, the Gentleman Rhymer goes, and Chap Hop, of all rather, like my brother actually sent me a text and said it was great, which, you know, being my brother, he never says that sort of thing. It's all nonsense. But, you know, generally he's very supportive, but he's outwardly supportive, which is not like him. So hopefully people will enjoy it.
Do you ever have any plans on pressing any of your albums in, like, vinyl?
Well, yeah, well, there's always vague plans. I can never quite tell, you know, with vinyl these days, I can never tell how many you ought to make and how many...
Right.
You know, I don't want it to be like, you know, things used to be. I used to run a little label and things like that, and you'd end up... You know, your bed would be about another foot higher than it used to be. You've got stacks and stacks of vinyl, you know, basically you're sleeping on.
Yeah.
And that sort of thing. But, yes, hopefully at some point. I'm not sure exactly how I'd go about it. I mean, I'd love to press some 78s. That would be rather lovely.
Right.
But, again, it's probably like the moustache wax. It's rather a niche, a niche audience for 78s.
Right.
Yeah.
But could work. But yes, hopefully at some point I'll definitely get some vinyl pressed, whether it'll be maybe just a 7-inch single or something like that, or I'll do a 7-inch single just to test the water and see what people think.
Right.
It could work.
Nice.
We shall see.
Well, I think everyone would be more than happy with 7 inches. So.
Yes.
Ladies. Anyway.
that bombshell.
Oh boy!
I inserted a partridge right at the last moment.
Yeah,
you'll have it right under the wire.
Is there anything else other than gentlemanrhymer.com that you'd like to plug, or another site or anything?
Well, there's obviously, I mean, there's, you know, I'm at gentlemanrhymer on Twitter and Instagram and things like that, and the Facebook's, you know, facebook.com/gentlemanrhymer.
Okay.
Generally speaking, you'll find me on those things. I don't know if anybody's leaving Facebook in droves. There's all sorts of rumours of people, you know, leaving various social media sites. It's quite hard to keep up with the whole thing.
It's true.
I don't think
anyone
can actually leave Facebook.
No, we are trapped there.
Yeah. Yeah. We're doomed.
Perhaps if I give Mark Zuckerberg the banjolele brooch, maybe he'll leave us be.
Ah,
that's the key to it all. All right.
There we go. Take the brooch and leave us alone.
I guess, yeah. Thanks for joining us on our measly podcast.
Well, thank you for having me, chat. It's been a pleasure.
Yeah, it's we've definitely enjoyed it.
Yes.
So. Splendid.
And I've got to say, just keep on making the sounds that you've been making, Mr. B. Your stuff is... I'm going to be completely honest. I am totally fangirling over you as a 42-year-old man with a wife and a family, but...
He's curtsying. You can't see
absolutely,
it.
I am dead set curtsying. But yeah, no, I absolutely love your stuff and just keep on doing what you're doing.
I will do, Jeff. Awesome. I will. Worry not. There's plenty more where this came from, as they say.
Excellent.
As the actress said to the... No, no, sorry.
Oh, there we go.
Almost.
I'm just trying to go out on a high.
I got to tell you, well, I love when anyone... Sort of I love when anyone else who isn't like American is on the show, because I actually get English sense of humor, and I for the first time in ages, I don't feel isolated on a podcast anymore. It's fantastic.
Well, that's good to hear. I'm happy to be of service, Oz.
Jeez.
Well, all right. Well, thanks again, and
thanks, chaps.
Hopefully, the next album does well and.
Yes, with any luck.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We shall see.
Yeah.
Well, thanks very much for having me, chaps. It's been great. It's been great fun.
All right. Well, thank you.
Excellent.
Thanks very much, sir.
And we'll catch up, no doubt, online and that sort of thing in the Junus, of course.
Yes.
Absolutely. Yes,
absolutely.
Good stuff. Cheers then, chaps.
All right. See ya.
Bye. Cheerio.
Well, that was fun.
Mm-hmm.
An incredibly nice guy.
Yeah. Extremely.
So, admittedly, sort of, I did do the creepy fangirling thing a little bit too much.
That's all right. We didn't do much to stop you. We just kind of stood back and let you.
I definitely want to get my hands on his banjo-lele pin. I'm just throwing that out there. I would never say that on our podcast, but, you know.
Right. Right. That's all right. I'll just isolate that clip and make sure Jason gets it.
He could probably put that on sort of a poster for
right.
the future. Like,
yeah. Oh, man. That was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed that.
Good.
Yeah. So
I wasn't trying to dominate the podcast too much with my questions, but I did have quite a few.
No, no worries.
So it's always good when I end up by taking control of someone else's podcast. Like, I don't do that enough on our own show.
Well, that's fine. I was taking notes like a fool because, you know, there were so many things being dropped on there. I want to make sure that, you know, I've got links and everything for everybody to check out.
Well, absolutely. Yeah. You never asked him about the Bota question, though.
The what?
So,
the what?
The Bota question as to which is the Bota... strictly
right.
a summer hat or a winter hat. To my knowledge, it is essentially just a summer hat.
Yeah.
But
I forgot we had that conversation the other night, and I told you, well, I was going to ask him.
You are actually sort of on Michigan, and you know you do have Grand Rapids there, and I can only assume that some Grand Rapids of water and not sort of, you know, crime.
It's mostly crime.
I assume that if you have Grand Rapids and water, you would immediately be drawn towards wearing a boater. Maybe we can get Benjamin Andre 3000 on, and you could ask him a similar thing, because he's worn a boater before.
That's true. He has. I would love to have him on the show. That'd be really interesting. That'd be a hell of a get.
Yeah, no shit.
Well, we could get him and B back on the show together, actually. That would be one hell of a... look, I'd leave our podcast for this one.
You do know we're still recording, right?
Oh, shit.
I told you before, I always record everything for blackmail purposes.
There's nothing like a little bit of blackmail. That's what she said. Oh, damn, B's not on.
Yeah. You know what I loved is, you know, most of the time, you know, when we do this show, it's just us being it's just nonsense and us just acting a fool, you know. And with him, it was, you know.
We kind of kept ourselves in line.
Yeah, yeah. But the curtsying thing danced its way through almost the whole show.
Yeah, it was sprinkled throughout.
Which is typical for us to have the callback thing. So, you know, I do like that we now have something going forward, because just saying second base now is going to make me think of the curtsying thing, or just saying curtsying has a new meaning to me, because yeah. before that I would always think of my dad used to curtsy all the time. And I don't know why I didn't bring that up. It just hit me. I actually have a picture on my Facebook page of my dad curtsying. So it's one of my favorite pictures of my dad. Now I don't know. I may now have to take it down. It's sullied.
It's full of shame now.
Forever unclean.
When you actually asked, your daughter asked Tony whether or not Mr. B had ever seen the Queen, I was going to actually ask, the second part of the question was whether or not he'd actually met Dame Edna. But I realised it's not Queen in the same context. So.
Right. What would have been great is when you asked, like, have you ever seen the Queen, if he would just have misunderstood you and been like, oh, yeah, that Freddie Mercury is an excellent boy, you know?
Yeah, I loved Queen.
Yeah. I've sampled him a few times. No, I'm just, yeah. Oh, man. Well, it's good fun. Well, I hope this exposes, you know, him to a few more, or, you know, a few more people.
Maybe
to
sell some more mustache wax.
Yes. Yes.
Poor guy.
You know, maybe get him back over to the States so we could actually see him. Because
the one thing I like.
Then I can get his brooch for Oz.
Don't worry, I have my ways.
Or for myself.
The one thing I do like about him, and this is without a word of a lie.
Well,
like,
aside from him being dreamy, and you were.
Anyway, moving on. One thing I do like about him is on Twitter, he's like enormously personable. Like he follows back without actually questioning. He always yep. answers the questions that he's asked.
Mm-hmm.
He's totally down to earth. And to be frank, seeing what he's actually done, he really doesn't have to be that sort of guy.
Yeah, right. Very true.
And he's a really nice guy. And we're like, sort of as a, you know, when you sort of announce you had him on the show, I just jaw smacked on the ground.
Yeah.
It's just one of those moments. Like, you know, I mean, that's a dude that actually earns the term celebrity.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So,
yeah.
Well, I'm fangirling again.
You know, and no matter what, it's nice to, you know, when you have something you're interested
back,
in.
Stand back, I'm about to throw my spats onto the stage.
I already have my pocket square out. you know, it's always nice when you can get, if you can get somebody that you have respect for what they do, or someone that, yeah. you know, that you like what they do. You know, it's, I always like listening to those podcasts.
It's even better when they turn out to be a good guy.
Right. Yeah. True enough.
Nothing worse when they're like a horrible person.
Yeah. Like they show up and then they realize that, you know, I've heard some podcasts where you can tell that the guest feels like they're bigger than the show.
Yeah.
And even if they are, they shouldn't make the show feel that way, just like the show shouldn't make the guest feel that way, you know?
Right, exactly. Yeah.
We had Ken Christensen on a little while back, who's the creator of Todd the Ugliest Kid on Earth.
Oh, yeah, right.
but, like, he was an absolutely – not only was he a really nice guy to talk to, but when sort of Jay was mentioning writing sort of Grindhouse – Funhouse 2, and I actually hit Ken up to sort of be one of the voices on the show. He immediately said yes. Didn't miss a beat, didn't consider it for a second, just said, yeah, I'll do it.
Oh, nice.
Straight away. And for a dude to actually do that, I mean, it's just brilliant. We seem to be garnering the goodwill of some people that are legitimate celebrities in their own right, and mm-hmm. it's the small little details, their own decency that absolutely makes them the real deal.
Right.
So, you know, and I think that's what celebrity is. It's those qualities. It's not whether or not they're on the film. It's not their wage or their lifestyle.
Right.
It's actually who they are.
Right.
You know, I remember the first time that I went to the Wizard World Chicago. Me and my girlfriend stood in line because Top Cow had a panel that had Mark Silvestri. What's his name? David Finch, is that right?
Yeah.
It had him, Michael Turner, I can't remember who else. There was like two more artists on it or writers, I can't remember. But anyway, it was like five or six people. And when we were going through the line, when I got to Mark Silvestri, I was like, you know, I'm a big fan of, you know, I love the fact that, like, I admire what he had done, you know, to get where he had gotten and everything. And
right.
he was like, you know, he's like, it's amazing to me that people say that kind of stuff to me. He's like, I'm just a guy who draws comics. He's like, mm-hmm. I'm not a celebrity. I'm not, you know, couldn't have been nicer to us, you know? And I was like, you know, I was like, cool. It's interesting that at a Comic-Con, you see an artist or a creator that's essentially worshipped. I mean, there's a huge line for this, you know. I mean, and granted, most of it was probably for Michael Turner at the time. But yeah. Silvestri's still a big name, you know.
Right.
And, you know, like, even with that giant line of people, he was still, like, just like, you know, it just blows my mind that anybody wants me to scribble on a book for him, you know.
Yeah.
And Jim Lee was the same way the first time I met him. You know,
yeah.
And the first time I met Brian Michael Bendis, there was no one at his table.
Mm.
He was just there peddling his, you know, his
wares.
Yeah. Well, he was peddling like, I can't think of the names of the books now. Wow. Some of his earlier stuff at that table. And, you know, and I was like, cool, I can buy this stuff and talk to him for a few minutes and not get bothered by. And again, it was in Chicago. It's not like it was,
right.
You know, some small town. Con
the Akron yeah. Comic-Con
he remember. was at his yeah. You know, and it was just that he was at his own booth,
right?
You know, it was, but again, it was the same thing because I was like, oh man, I love, what was it, Goldfish or Jinx or something like that,
yeah,
one of those. I'm like, I love the way you
read,
you know.
I've read that. Well, that's a good read.
And you know, and he was like, oh cool, you know, I'm glad you like it. And all, it was just, you know, that was before he was doing like everything Marvel has, but you know.
Mm. Wow. Two of the people that have surprised me in the time that I've met them, and I like, I don't like name dropping because like it makes me sound like a dick, but right. I'm going to mention it.
See, I don't mind sounding like a dick, so it's fine.
No. it's all right to say dick because Mr. B said it.
Right. Also, this show is called Salty Language.
It's true.
Absolutely. One of the people that actually surprised me with how down to earth and nice he was Jackie Chan. When I filmed with him, late 90s, doing what was the film, First Strike, and just in terms of a dude that's actually willing to go around, shake everyone's hands, talk, and legitimately seem to like people. I mean, we were shooting up the main street of Mooloolaba Beach in Queensland at the time, and the dude's actually stopping doing what he's doing and walking to the garden of the location where we're at and picking up trash and putting it in the bin himself. Like, the dude didn't have to do that.
Yeah.
And the other person that sort of surprised me was Stan Lee when I met him this year, which, like, my life had been building up to this moment for at least, like, 35 years.
Right.
And just sort of cracking the joke with him, and he basically gave it back. It's sort of, as soon as I went in there, he saw my daughter and he said, oh, that's, look at you. He said, you can stand up next to me. And I said, no, I can get on the other side of you. And he said, I prefer you didn't. I said, you better be nice to me, Stan. I made you a lot of money during the 70s. And he said, yes, and now you're paying for this photo. So I obviously got you twice. And I just thought, what a decent dude.
Yeah.
For him to actually take time out of it. Yeah, so these are the people that are definitely the real celebrities. So
yeah, yeah.
They've kept their common touch yet walk amongst kings.
Yeah,
to quote Kipling. So yeah. I should have done that while B was on. I would have had more of a chance getting a hold of his banjolele pin. So
you never had a chance of it.
No, I know.
Yeah,
still, you know,
it's going to take some sort of spec ops mission. He's probably locking it down as we speak.
Maybe.
He's got a safe deposit box now, you know.
Yes, in the Surrey Fortress Citadel.
Yes. Meanwhile. Oh, man.
Good stuff.
It was, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I agree. I really, really dug how, like his roots with this and stuff. It was such an interesting thing. Like the first time I heard any of the Chap Hop stuff,
right?
You know, and I'll admit the first I heard was actual. It was Fighting Trousers.
Yeah, same here.
Likewise.
Yeah.
And then I don't remember who it was that told me that Mr. B was essentially the subject of the song, and then I checked out his stuff, and I was like, oh, I'm a big fan of this guy.
The history of hip-hop.
That was actually
It was the history of hip-hop.
I thought it was Oz. I thought so, too.
I couldn't remember if it was you or our friend Don is a fan of
Professor Elemental.
Look, and to be fair, like those guys, both their music, it's completely different.
It really is.
Yeah.
Like, I really respect, like, what Professor Elemental does, but the one thing I notice about his is actually a performance as well. So it's definitely a character.
Mm-hmm.
What he's doing, it's definitely a theme thing. It's all about the steampunk. There's elements of comedy in there. Yeah, but the one thing that I've got from Mr. B, and sort of having seen his stuff before and currently, like, you can actually see the narrative of what he's been there, and he is a legitimate musician.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, even though there are comedic elements to what he does, and I won't lie, I mean, the guy is definitely an artist.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, see, I actually, that's part of what draws me to him as a musician, though, is, well, not that I'm a musician, but, you know, him as a musician, is mm-hmm. that, much like you said about how, you know, he keeps, like, the angry Oz at bay, basically. Like, a couple nights ago, I was just going through, and I just put, you know, I had a playlist of his stuff, and I just put it on random. And, you know, just song after song, and there's always something that just makes me smile or laugh. Like, you'll catch just a phrase where even the ones where he's redone, or, you know, like, the history of hip-hop's a great one,
right,
you know, where he changes some things so that they're more, you know, they fit his style, and it's fantastic.
And I meant to bring it up. I forgot all about it. His Christmas song.
Oh, yeah.
With about Santa drinking the sherry and then shoving the carrot in his ass. Yeah. What? I think I watched it at 5 in the morning trying to, like, silently laugh so I didn't wake up my wife.
Yeah. Yeah, I saw that the other night. Like, I didn't even know about it, and I saw it on, was it iTunes or something? Yeah. And I was like, what the? Yeah.
Yeah, the video's great.
But again, I loved his comments about how he feels that chap hop, or this in general, can kind of go different directions, even within the same kind of thing. Yeah. You know, again, like hip-hop is done, you know, and stuff. You know, and I am very curious to see if some of this other, like you were mentioning, Oz, the steam funk or steampunk funk, whichever you want to call it, or the chap core. I'm curious to see if either of those kind of pushes the genre a little bit, or if they're just one trick pony kind of things, you know?
Well, my mate that's actually doing it.
Speaking of, I need to get his name or a link from you for that.
Oh yeah. Masashi Lethbridge is the guy's name. He's, good Lord, I've known him for, at least since 2004. I mean, the guy used to do, he's written songs for me for, like, the web-based cooking program I used to do ages ago, Drunk and Angry in the Kitchen, which, as it was, I think the girl that's doing it now is named Harto, has basically taken my show and decided to run with it, and she became a celebrity, whereas I became a podcaster.
Right. So you chose right, yeah.
Yeah. So, like, he did the music for that completely gratis. He's written that many different styles of music, everything from country to reggae.
Mm-hmm.
He's been in a couple of different ska bands, the Boss Tones. I think it's the Boss Tones. Anyway, it doesn't matter. But, like, a whole bunch of different bands. I think he'd written one steam funk song. It's actually on SoundCloud, most of his stuff. So I'll send you the link for that.
Okay.
Anyway, but yeah, Moose's stuff is really great. So it's
but again, you know, you appreciate that, you know, like you were saying, how he's written or been in various, you know, types of music. He's not like Mr. B was saying, not pigeonholing.
Right.
He's, you know,
It's one thing to actually sort of be well known for a particular sound,
right?
But, you know, if you're hoping to grow sort of as a performer, you know, you do have to break the mold a little bit, because if you're going to grow,
right,
you can't stay where you are.
I read, was it a week or two ago? Somebody actually for Vice wrote an article talking about how people should no longer be ashamed for having any music on their iPod. Like, it doesn't matter how bad the song is. They were like, look, the whole point of music
is to listen to it,
is to be subjective. Yeah. No matter what it invokes in you, that's what it invokes in you. It's no different than art.
Yeah.
Sometimes you'll look at a piece of art in a museum or on someone's wall, and you're like, that looks like hot garbage.
Right.
But you know what? Maybe they look at it, and that's their happy place or whatever. And if so, there's nothing wrong with that, even if it's for you, you know.
On my iPhone, I've got chap hop, I've got ACDC, I've got like late 90s, early 2000 hip-hop, and I've even got an ABBA album on there because like, ABBA was what I grew up listening to.
Right.
And like one of my favorite songs, and I'm going to admit it on your show, and I'm not ashamed of it. God damn it.
That's what we're talking about here.
It's Jeremy Jordan's Right Kind of Love. Seriously, I love that song. I love singing that song. I sing it really loud in the car, but if there's a red light, I wind up the windows as tight as I can and sing really quietly. I know you can't hear me.
Like holding your hand over your mouth so they don't lip read.
So I do it like I've got a facial tic. So if anyone sees me sort of in their rear vision mirror, it looks like, I don't know, I'm trying to sort of keep sort of enclosed up for the right reason. Like I invented a drink today called the prune juice martini. I didn't tell you that, but I'm having, we slightly segued, trust me.
Right, it doesn't sound like a great drink.
Because
it's going to become his regular drink. See what I did there?
I don't think I could actually survive that. I've actually had to push my femur back inside me three times during this podcast.
That's not a femur.
So that's why you can't see the microphone stand. it's playing merry hell with my liver at the moment. Anyway, but like this, because I'm sort of directly after I went and did Comic-Con here, I sort of decided, because I'd actually bulked up quite large for it, I just went, now I can start to relax. I can start eating again. So I ate and I ate and I ate, and I had like those killer breakfasts because I love breakfasts, as you can probably appreciate.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you were definitely posting some big breakfasts there.
And then some. Like I sort of bulked up a little bit too much, and I just noticed that when I was standing there one day, for some reason I was hard breathing, and like I noticed that I was actually hard breathing, which was really putting me off my third mug of gravy.
Let that stand in the way.
That's right.
At the KFC drive-thru. So one of the things when I actually lost a whole bunch of weight the first time is I ended up doing a detox with prune juice. And a thing called lactulose that's based on corn syrup. And if you've ever wanted to know what is at the end of the tunnel when you see that bright light when you die, have lactulose. Seriously, I guarantee you, you will never, ever, ever look at the toilet the same way again. Wow. It was like I basically flushed away my circulatory system within 10 minutes. I've decided to downscale that. It's now we're talking about the real saucy stuff. A little bit.
Well, it's about time.
Yeah, just when you thought we were going to put out a classy show.
You've already had the Mr. B. Now it's time for the Mr. BM.
So, you know, if I wasn't just going to name the show basically about Mr. B., that would be probably be the name.
We can call it Oz's Crap Hop.
Dropping the beets or something.
No, he's having prunes, not beets.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah.
Either way, it looks bloody.
Oh man, this has just gone in the toilet.
We were talking about chivalry, and sometimes it's appropriate to push in someone's stool. this podcast, I was pushing in my own.
Oh
so
man!
Anyway, I've decided to drink my prune juice martini out of a 900ml mug, so I'm expecting something particularly special very shortly.
I'm assuming that mug is bigger on the inside.
Yeah, so anyway, I decided I had to sort of lose a bit of weight to get myself back into shape because this month I'm going to be putting on the Batman suit and if they get back to me. Again, we're doing a couple of appearances at a kids' cancer ward.
Nice.
In sort of Sydney as Batman. And like I'm financing a bit of it myself. Like you've probably seen them all. I've got a whole bunch of Mounted comics and that sort of thing behind me. I'm actually selling a lot of those off to finance this. And, you know, the stuff that I don't sell is actually being donated to the ward. Because, I mean, fuck it. I've gone pretty much digital anyway.
Yeah,
and right. So the money that I make is actually going to sort of buy sort of cardboard masks and that sort of thing, and Texicolor, so the kids can actually make the masks themselves, then pose with their superheroes. So we've got a Spider-Man, a Harley Quinn, a Poison Ivy, and a Captain America, and I'll be going as Batman. So we're going there for a visit. So I'm going to be doing that. So I figure if I actually do go there, they're probably not going to want to see like a fat Batman wheezes. And like, you know, the kids got enough going on in their life. I don't want to be, you know, the last nail in the coffin.
Just tell them that you're not wheezing, you're doing the Christian Bale Batman voice.
That's true.
Batman's allergic to prawns.
Just, you know,
some adrenaline.
Batman's gonna sit down.
He used to be Dark Knight Returns Batman. He's like stockier and thicker, and you know, wheezing because he's old.
Breaks your neck and then follows by breaking his hip. If anything, for me, it'd be Dark Knight Reclines.
That sounds lovely. Actually,
he slips on some shark bat repellent.
Dark Knight Refrains.
Well, good luck with your mug of accelerant you have next to you.
Yes, I'm calling it my late nitro.
Man, you're not planning on going to bed after that, are you?
I'm planning on going everywhere, but
I was going to say, you've at least warned the wife, right?
I am going to probably sleep down on the couch. I mean, it's now 4:30 a.m. I'm pretty much pulled an all-nighter. Like, I had a sleep on the couch leading up to the podcast for about 4 hours, so I should be right to go. Like, we've got quite a big day planned. I mean, it's not as big as the album launch we went to the other night, where I had like an hour and a half sleep for the entire time and then lapsed into a coma.
Looked like a fine party by the Instagram pictures, though.
Well, it was a lot of fun, and like my eldest daughter was just on fire, so it was actually a really good night. And tomorrow, like, I'm going to we bought these cabinets from IKEA, so yes, it's going to be one of those stories. We'll call it Ozkia. So we went to there because, like, we've managed to actually have a very small wardrobe, but my wardrobe of clothing and my wife's has actually grown exponentially, as is our want. And like, I went into IKEA and bought these things. And the one, like, we at 5 p.m., we'd had these three things sort of flat-packed and ready to go for a while. And I said to the wife, okay, well, we should start this now so we'd be finished by 10. Like fuck we were. by 2:30 a.m., we'd managed to finally put it together. We spent 45 minutes on one fucking drawer. This is the reason that the Vikings never conquered the Western world, was because all their ships had to be assembled by fucking Allen keys, and they rocked when you leaned against them. Fuck IKEA. So we only assembled one. We've got two still in flat packs. Tomorrow, or rather today, we're actually going to shove them in a trailer and then drive back to IKEA and demand our money back.
They're just going to pay you in meatballs.
Thank God for their refund policy. It was just ridiculous.
Meatballs and Allen wrenches and spare parts. That's what they pay you back in.
And sawdust.
Yeah.
You didn't like the wardrobe? Here, have like 900 picture frames.
They don't fit together.
It would actually be easier to assemble those into a fucking wardrobe than the monstrosity that's currently in our bedroom. It's not so much a wardrobe, it's a fucking landmass. Even our whole bedroom doesn't look... I have to actually walk past a corner now to get into our bedroom. I mean, the corner's so large, it's already been tagged, and there's hawkers work in the corner.
I was going to say, make sure you watch out for that when, you know, after you've had a few.
I'm thinking of actually subletting it so we can actually get some students to move in.
A rental property.
That's a good idea. Yeah. Nice.
A studio apartment.
You know,
in New York, that'd be
$5,000. I was just going to say that. Yep. At least, yeah.
Yeah, good stuff.
This was that real estate boom we'd obviously heard about.
Yes.
Thanks to IKEA.
Yeah.
Yes.
Who knew?
The Swedes. Rescue us again.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. All right, well, we should probably wrap this up, I would assume, right?
Probably. We're closing in probably an hour and a half with some of the, you know, beginning stuff trimmed out or whatever else. Yeah.
Yeah.
No.
So.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, thanks, Oz.
Yeah.
Oh, no, thank you for the invite. Always. So I was hardly going to talk to him on my own, was I?
Yeah, you never know.
I don't know.
Your show gives me the veneer of legitimacy that stalking would probably not.
Yeah, yeah.
Fair enough.
That's
right?
Probably true. Yeah, he's already sent us a message saying, you know, I'd come back on the show, make sure Oz is not part of it. So, no. I kid.
Oh, shut up.
All right, well, I guess we do the obligatories at this point.
Might as well.
Oz, do you want to plug your stuff here real quick?
Yeah, if you want to check us out, what are we? 7daysofgeek.net. That's our website. You can check it out. It's got links to our shows. We're on Stitcher. We're on iTunes. If you want to follow me on Twitter, I'm at angry_Oz_geek. If you want to check out our Facebook page, just look for like 7 Days of Geek and go there. If you want to follow my hetero ginger life mate, Jay, he's at 7 Days of Geek, which is at S7EVEN Days of Geek. If you want to follow any of the other guys, it's at That McBlizzard. I'm not going to spell it out. Just look for my tweets. You'll see him come up. If you want to follow Grant, it's at Instagram something or other. I think Instagram it's too.
I think so.
Just look for my feed. You'll find it. That's TK1. And don't forget, we've got our 100th episode that is coming up very shortly. Close to a 4.5 hour podcast. So it's mostly all awful, but people seem to like it.
Make sure you either don't have the prune martini ahead of time.
Right.
Or have it.
But have headphones.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And seriously, you know, check out our show if you've got nothing better going on in your life.
Speaking of having nothing better in your life, go to saltylanguage.com.
Yeah.
Where we have all of our links. Such as a bunch from this episode, between the ones that
I feel like my work cut out for me Sunday.
Yeah, you're gonna be in trouble this week.
Yeah.
The different things Mr. B has mentioned, we'll try to get as many of the links as we can up there, including ones to his site and his musics and whatnot.
GentlemanRhymer.com.
Right, which is yeah. And again, we'll have all his Twitter and everything. You can also find the Pod Gods link to check out the network. Or other shows in the network, such as 7 Days of Geek that Oz mentioned, or A Little Punch Drunk, or the Green Up Podcast.
Dark Angels, Pretty Freaks.
Yep.
The list goes on and on.
Yeah, on and on. Hanging
Out.
I'm
not
going
to try
to
name them all, because it's just...
There's like a billion of them.
Yeah.
So, let's see. Yeah, and then, you can get all of our back episodes on the website as well. So, you know, definitely go check out a bunch of those. Including, you know, the one that Oz was on just a few episodes ago with me, which was called Meat Tent.
good old Meat Tent.
Where Oz has some amazing stories about vasectomy. And
yes, I lived it, so you didn't have to. Yeah.
Yes. Or check out, what was it, Condom Full of Walnuts, I believe?
Yes.
Oh,
the original Oz episode.
That was a way back.
Which was a fantastic episode as well. If you want to check us out on Twitter, the show is at salty_language. I'm at Stunami.
I'm at Monotony.
And I think that's everything.
Yeah.
If not, you know, again, links are on saltylanguage.com. Oh, you know what we didn't say?
What did we not say?
You can buy Mr. B's music, I would assume, as well as various other things on Amazon.com by going to saltylanguage.com.
That's true. Click the banner at the top.
Yep. And then shop away.
Yeah.
Buy lots of things. You know, like look me up and buy off my wish list.
There you go.
Like the Medicom Dark Knight Batman that I just added to it.
Oh, yeah.
It's only $209.
Oh, well, let me just reach
my... Listen, I'll be your... I will friend you on Twitter or all social media that I can if you buy it for me. I think that's a pretty fair
deal. It's a hell of a deal,
I'll
really.
Also do a drawing for someone.
He says that trying not to sound like a whore as well, so this is just a gift.
Right.
So.
Now, I'll do a drawing for people, too. I'll do a Batman drawing for him.
There
not that that'll ever work. I've offered drawings various times.
Will you draw them like one of your French girls?
Yes.
Oh, okay, cool.
Now I get. Now you're meaning that I'm drawing as a French girl drawing Batman, right?
Of course.
Okay. So I'll be lounging on the couch, nude, of course. No
Look,
pictures,
that
though.
That is the Batpole.
And now that everyone's done vomiting, I guess we say have a beer, you'll be fine.
I think it should be like have a sherry, you'll be fine.
You're right. We'll class it up a little bit class this time, so, I guess.
So, yeah. And, you know, I look, I can't really say go fuck yourself.
I know, right? That's, yeah.
Yeah. Stay salty, though.
Curtsy.
Yeah, and go curtsy yourself.
Go curtsy yourself, yes.